Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All right, if we could come to order, please. This is the April 15th, 2019, 7 p.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I am Chair Amy Scott Gailey, and the other four commissioners are all present. So I will lead us, if you care to. It's not required by any stretch, but if you care to join me in prayer, please do. Heavenly Father, we just lift up our hearts this evening to you. Our world seems like it changes so fast, and things that mean a lot to people just seem to disappear. And we just know that it's just a building, Lord, but we are grieving about the loss of the Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. And we just are thankful, Lord, that nobody appears to have been hurt in that. We just pray that our hearts would turn toward you, Lord, and that we would remember that things of this earth are here for just a time, but there are things that are eternal, and help us to seek those with our hearts and our minds, Lord, and our lives. I pray that your hand of blessing would be on this board, on this body, as we deliberate tonight, that our thoughts, our actions, our words would be pleasing in your sight, that you would guide our decisions and our processes, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all the people in this community who work in service of other people, such as the rescue squad, such as EMS, our law enforcement, and our firemen, volunteer firemen. Lord, those who serve the community, teachers, nurses, and people in medical field who seek to make other people's lives better. We thank you for the service of our military at home and overseas, and we pray that your hand of blessing would be on them and that you would honor their service, Lord, with protection and with meaning. And we just thank you for all the blessings. Thank you for allowing us to see this day, and may all we do be pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
If you would join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, so first item on our agenda is the public speakers. We have two public comment policies now, one for agenda-related items at the beginning of the meeting, and then a second for non-agenda-related items at the end. It looks like all of those people who have signed up to speak tonight have signed up to speak on agenda-related items. Briefly, let me note that we have a public comment policy, a copy of which I think is posted by the lectern where people can sign up as they come in. It's also on our website. Let me just go over a couple of things really quickly. Speaker comments, the public comment period is limited to a maximum of 30 minutes total. Each person desiring to speak during the public comment period has 3 minutes to make his or her remarks. There will be no more than 3 speakers on any one topic per meeting. And we have quite a few people signed up to speak on the noise ordinance tonight. And the way that we've interpreted this policy is that we would have 3 people speaking in favor of an item and 3 people speaking against an item on the agenda. So we have quite a few on the noise ordinance, and it's not noted whether or not they're in favor or not favoring changing the noise ordinance. And so we'll be kind of keeping an eye on that as we go along. There are 8 people who are signed up, and if there's 3 people who speak for and 3 people who speak against, then that sounds like there might be at least 2 people who are signed up who will not be speaking. So I hope that makes sense. When you come to the front of the room, you address the board from the lectern. Please state your name and address so that our clerk to the board can make a note of that in the minutes. If you have a disabling condition that you need some kind of accommodation for, if you would help let us know, and we would be glad to help you with that. Also, please silence your phones. If you would do that, that would be useful and helpful. Let me make sure I did. I had not. So there you go. Now, public comment is not intended to require the Board of Commissioners to answer any impromptu questions. Please address all comments to the commissioners as a whole and not to individual commissioners. Discussions between speakers and members of the audience are not allowed. Please be courteous in your language and presentation. If you have prepared written remarks, you can submit those to the clerk, and she'll make a note of those for the minutes, and they'll be included in our minutes for the meeting. Then there's some stuff that speakers aren't supposed to address, stuff like if anybody's running for office, matters which are the subject of public hearings, matters which are closed session matters, stuff like that. And then don't cuss and don't use racial slurs, et cetera, et cetera. So all that being said, the first person we have signed up to speak is Tracy Lee. So Mrs. Lee, if you would come. Thank you.
I have a question, because you said state your address, but it says here name and city of residence, so I'm not sure which one I'm supposed to do.
You can just do what it says there.
Okay.
We'll change that for the next meeting.
Okay. I am Tracy Lee, and I live in Burlington. Having spent my entire life in Alamance County, I have decades-old memories of yearly portrait sessions held at the County Rescue Building. Fast forward some odd years, and my own spouse has become a member of this group that provides both supplemental and elevated services to our community. I was absolutely stunned to learn that nearly half a century later, this type of fundraising event is still a major staple of this operation. For their assumption of first responder and emergency medical duties for the city of Graham, and only for this portion of the services they provide, Alamance County Rescue receives a small annual stipend from the county. Should the dynamics of this arrangement change, this one and only steady source of funding may well disappear. Shame on me for not having exercised my right and my responsibility to be a well-informed citizen, and instead assuming that the viability of this essential service had always been assured by the collective, as is every other resource necessary for the health and welfare of this life we lead. I find it unfathomable and unconscionable that the continuation of these necessary specialized services, often the difference between life and death, could be entirely dependent upon the likes of bingo nights, bake sales, and raffles. That seems a slippery slope for the citizens of Alamance County. I implore you to allot a portion of my tax dollars to support the Alamance County Rescue Unit and the vital service that it provides.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have Stephanie Thurman. Maybe in the overflow room. And Ms. Thurman, will you be speaking for or against the noise ordinance?
Well, I'm speaking to have it revised. Is that your question?
So I guess for revision?
Yes. Okay. So I guess that would be against the way it's currently written. Is that what you're asking?
I'll call it for revising it. It's semantics.
Okay.
Just as a, or keeping track of it on here. Thank you.
Okay. My name is Stephanie Thurman, and I live at 149 Clark Road in Snow Camp. I'm not wasting any time tonight, and we'll get right to the point. The current noise ordinance contains an exemption for noises created by heavy industry, and this desperately needs to be removed and replaced with specific language that will restrict noisy external business operations to normal business hours. For example, 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday, much like Martin Marietta operations in Hall River in Burlington. This seems to be working out well for them. The noise ordinance was designed to prohibit noise disturbances or unreasonably loud noise in order to secure and promote the public health comfort, convenience, safety, and welfare and prosperity of the citizens of Alamance County. The current exemption is a complete contradiction of what the ordinance was designed to prohibit. With regard to the proposed Snow Camp Quarry, if the ordinance isn't revised, it will simply add insult to injury. And quite frankly, the citizens of Snow Camp deserve better. As a side note that is related to the hazards of a noisy, busy industrial area that never sleeps, Snow Camp Siler City Road from Snow Camp Store to the Chatham County line is a dangerous stretch of road. In 29 years, I've seen a lot of accidents from my kitchen window, some fatal, and add in a steady stream of dump trucks, and problems will surely result. If the state does approve the quarry, the county may want to consider lowering the speed limit and or putting up signage to illustrate the hazards ahead. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dunn.
Do I get this to you?
Sure, I'll just pass it down.
If you would pass that down to Corey, that would be appreciated. Jason Dowdle. So I'm thinking you're for revising the ordinance.
For revising, yes. Not substantially, just a couple little parts of it. My name is Jason Dowdle. I live in Snow Camp. And as I said, I'm here for to address you about the noise ordinance. As far as I can see, the industry exemption, to me it makes no sense. As it's written, the noise ordinance regulates how loud I can play my stereo, but industry gets absolutely a free pass. One point I'd like to make is that there are different types of industry. The noise ordinance only addresses industry, but lots of manufacturing operations are totally indoors and they don't make any noise, so there's really no problem there. But something like a rock quarry or an asphalt plant or a cement plant, all their heavy machinery is outdoors, so it seems like they need to be treated differently. And that seems to me what noise ordinances are for. And also I'd like to make the point that if you regulate the noise producing industries, the industries that don't make noise, that regulation is effectively invisible to them. It places no burden on them at all. So you're only burdening the people who make a lot of noise, and that seems to me that's what the noise ordinance is for. I also think it is critical to have time limits on industrial noise. I think it's absolutely reasonable to say that industrial noise needs to be contained between 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. And only allowed on weekdays. And I've looked into it, and every rock quarry in the area maintains their business between 7 a.m. and 5 p.m., weekdays only. So placing a restriction on noise on something like that same time period places no burden on them all, at all. It basically just kind of affirms what they're already doing. But it does make it so if someone does want to make a lot of noise at night, then you have a recourse to it. Otherwise, there's nothing a neighbor can do about it. I'd also like to say I'm a little bit frustrated with the process at this point. For example, at recent public hearings on the noise ordinance, Mr. Albright stated that you can't put time limits on businesses, but that seems to me it's not correct. The noise ordinance we're talking about actually puts time restrictions on the construction business in residential areas. So clearly you can regulate the time that businesses are allowed to make noise, because it's already been done. Mr. Albright also stated that that industrial noise should be addressed in the context of the HIDO and not in the context of the noise ordinance. And to me, I go, why? We're talking about noise, and it's a noise ordinance. It seems a perfect place to address it. It gets an exemption. Why can't it get a regulation in the noise ordinance? And finally, I'd like to bring the attention to the county's... That went by quick.
All right, thank you.
Anyway, I got the main points across. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Jim Young. Mr. Young,
hello.
Will you be speaking for revising the ordinance or against revising the ordinance?
Against revising it.
Okay.
You know, my name is Jim Young. I live in Graham, and I come as the president of Durham Pistol Rifle Club. And if I'm not mistaken, there is a state law that prohibits anyone else from establishing ordinances to prevent sport shooting, anything like that, or regulates that. I'm not sure what the ordinance is, but I do represent over 1,300 members, most of which are in Alamance County. And you add their spouses to that, their kids that come in as guests that are adults, they vote. And I just wanted to voice my opinion on just leaving it alone. But the previous speakers about the construction, you know, most of my members at our club, they all have common sense. We're not going out at midnight and firing off shots or anything. Fireworks, that's another thing, but shooting off guns and stuff, most of our members, I'd say the majority of them all have a little common sense. We're not going to go out and fire guns and wake our neighbors up. But just in the construction end of it, I think the two previous speakers do have a point as far as what kind of construction goes on in that area. And you could always make the construction companies erect walls, just like gun ranges have berms to stop the bullets, and it also helps keep the noise in. So that's just my two cents. I appreciate y'all. I appreciate the job you're doing. I would not want it, but I had to come in and speak for my members.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right,
thank
you. Good
evening. Appreciate you. Okay, Laura Johnson.
Speak because the previous two speakers touched on my comments. I want to make sure everyone else has a chance.
Okay, so you're going to pass?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Then Andy Stevens.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Mr. Vice Chair, Commissioners, staff, and visitors. My name is Andy Stevens, and I reside in Stokes County. I'm here tonight representing Grassroots North Carolina, grnc.org, our state's no compromise gun rights organization. I am the statewide director of local government affairs for GRNC. I respectfully ask you to permanently table your proposed noise ordinance modification item 7-2 tonight. It appears to be directed solely as step one towards banning the lawful discharge of firearms on private property throughout Alamance County. It uses the term unnecessary. Since when has the exercise of a constitutional right been defined as unnecessary in Alamance County? The truth is, freedom is dangerous, and yes, sometimes noisy. We should embrace it and not criminalize it. My time is brief, so let me summarize the defects of your proposed ordinance here tonight. Number one, it stands in violation of state law as it adds new regulations on existing shooting ranges. Check North Carolina General Statute 14-409.36. To be exact. Two, it defines the offense based in part on the time of day and the day of the week it occurs. These hours as defined appear to be arbitrary and capricious. Cannot residents who work a second or third shift schedule establish valid claims to extend these hours for their benefit as well? And as written, does it not in fact allow for such noise Sunday nights until the very stroke of midnight? It's silly no one proofs these things these days. Three, as I've described, your ordinance defines the exercise of a constitutional right itself as unnecessary. Four, it defines the offense as the repeated continuous firing of weapons. Bang, bang, bang. That's you teaching your young son or daughter, turning them into a criminal for firing a one-shot 22 caliber rifle as you teach him or her the fundamentals of marksmanship. Five, it defines whether the offense occurs in proximity to residential structures. Will practicing marksmanship make one a criminal by safely firing from one's own deck or yard? Will sheriff's deputies be issued measurement wheels calibrated in proximity? Have you explained to your constituents the cost to be incurred by sending sheriff's deputies on witch hunts across the county to the detriment of accomplishing more important tasks? Finally, this new ordinance merely pits one unhappy neighbor against another, or even neighbors, using overzealous government regulation and enforcement as a hammer. How many complaints have been documented over time to justify such draconian measures? Surely it must rival the number of burglaries, break-ins, and assaults across the county for it to merit such attention and direct repressive action by government. Do the benefits of accepting these new regulations outweigh the costs? I submit they do not. There is no benefit to be derived from summarily making criminals of free men, women, and children engaged in lawful pursuits. In conclusion, respectfully, I ask that you take this measure permanently off the table. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Lee Kimry.
Welcome, Lee. How you doing, Lee?
Thank you.
Glad you could find us.
Chair, Commissioners, I'm Lee Kimry. I live at 104 West Elm Street. I'm your neighbor right down the road, right here in Graham. So what I'd like to discuss with you briefly tonight is item number 7.11 on your agenda. Let me give you a little bit of history. 2004 was the first year in the city of Graham that we helped fund this, I'm going to call it county service. In 2005, it was asked that we look at continuing to fund this service, and I think it was thought upon at the time that we needed an agreement to help us move forward. Now, through the course of the last 14 years, and we don't have a clear explanation as to why that occurred, but it seemed to be a dramatic increase in the cost of helping to fund this service. It seemed to occur in 2009, but since 2005, we've seen a 148% increase in helping to fund this service with the county, Burlington, and other municipalities. 148% increase. Now, I know all of you on this board can appreciate and clearly understand how unsustainable that is in the future moving forward. When you look at what it currently equates to on our tax rate, that's 1 cent in the city of Graham. On our tax rate. You take a small municipality like Green Level, and that's 2 cents on their tax rate to help fund this service. There's an argument to be made, and it's made quite often in the city of Graham, that why is it our citizens in the city of Graham are paying over twice as much for the same service that county residents are only getting charged one time for? There's a fair argument to say that maybe our citizens are being charged or taxed twice for identical services. But let me say that the partnership that we have with the county and other municipalities is very valuable. This community has benefited greatly from how we work together collectively with the county, Burlington, and other municipalities. And the benefit, it's clear evidence in the animal shelter and how successful they have been. We have been such a good partner that in the past, about 4 to 5 years ago in the city of Graham, we actually implemented an animal control officer. We equipped them, bought the vehicle, all the equipment, and we incur about a $65,000 annual expense for that position. But we did it because we want to provide the best service to our citizens in the city of Graham and help to be a good partner with the county, because that lessens the burden, almost eliminates the burden on the Sheriff's Department on having to respond to animal control calls in the city of Graham. So please, I come to you tonight to please consider adopting the resolution, or I'm sorry, the agreement that you have in front of you. We think it's a fair and equitable way to be able to move forward, to remain a good partner, and to provide a valuable service to our citizen as well as the county in whole. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, thank you so much. Okay, John Betchell. Betchell. And I see that you signed up to speak about the noise ordinance.
Yes, I'm speaking against.
Yes, okay, thank you.
My name is John Bechtel. Currently live at 709 Vanderford Street in Burlington. I've been a resident of North Carolina since 1996 and have lived in Alamance County for the last 7 years. First of all, I'm here as a private citizen, firm believer in all the constitutional rights that were given to us by our founding fathers, including the right to bear arms. Anytime a government has to tell me that nothing in this ordinance is intended to deter individuals from lawfully exercising the individual right of freedom of speech or any other freedoms guaranteed under the constitutions of the United States or the state of North Carolina. Something tells me if they have to tell me that, they probably are, just a little. But those littles add up after a while. I'm also here as vice president of the Central Carolina Gun Club. We're located about 6 miles north of here, off of NC 62. As I said, this would affect us heavily, especially our members. The hours, like 9 a.m., it's not so much during the week, because we are basically a dawn-to-dusk operation. But on, you know, 9 a.m. Saturday, we have a lot of members that are out there first thing in the morning. Why? This is North Carolina, folks. What's it like here during July and August? So they get out there and try and get their shooting in the morning. Same with Sunday, 12:30. We have matches sometimes on Sunday mornings. Our club itself has a rule of Sunday mornings of not permitting shooting before 9 a.m. That's in favor of our neighbors. But we do have matches. They start shooting at 9 a.m. in the summer because it's cool. In the winter, if you don't start a match till 12:30 in the afternoon, you may not have the daylight hours to complete the match. I noticed on one thing where you stated about tonight's meeting, there was nothing in there under economic impact. Our matches bring in people from more than just Alamance County. Yes, we have over 600 members, many of them Alamance County residents. But I know we've had people come down from Virginia, all over parts of North Carolina, and, you know, to attend our matches. This does have an economic impact. These people buy gasoline, they eat at local restaurants, they may stop at a convenience store for a soda on their way out of town. But every dollar they spend here, from my former life in tourist industry, tells me that that multiplies generally about 7 times over. And I also have a concern about how this is going to be enforced. You know, how can you, you know, somebody's going to call in and say, hey, I heard a gunshot. How are you going to determine where the source of that gunshot was? You know, what's its location? You know, there's going to be a lot of he said, she said kind of a thing. And so it's going to be, in my opinion, difficult and an undue burden on the sheriff's department. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ketchum.
Okay, Noah Reed.
Thank you for the chance to speak tonight. My name is Noah Reed. I live in Burlington. I am the Secretary of the Alamance County Board of Elections, and I am here speaking as an individual member to ask for your support for the resolution that the Board of Elections unanimously adopted on our March 26th meeting, requesting an extension from the General Assembly on the December 31st, 2019 deadline for our county to purchase new voting machines that are compliant with the recent legislation requiring the use of paper ballots. We just ask for your support on that. Thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you, Noah.
Thank you.
Thank you. That item is on our consent agenda. Yeah. Henry Vines. Actually, 1, 2, 3, 4. I'll wait until Henry comes in. Hey Henry, we've already had us. You signed up to speak against the noise ordinance, and we've already had 3 people to speak against it. So you're out of luck. I'm sorry. We'll get you next
point
time.
Point of order. I'd like to ask now. Some of the people they spoke against the industrial,
right?
And some spoke against the or for the guns. To me, there's a difference, and it shouldn't be together to start with. But
okay.
I'd
well,
like for that distinction.
Sure. Come on, Henry. We haven't. No, we have a 30-minute limit, and we're still within that, so we'll squeeze you in.
Okay.
Yeah,
thank you.
Because it is a little complicated.
Thank you, Commissioners. I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to speak. I know you've heard a lot tonight, and you've heard a lot saying against the different types, the rock quarry, the shooting. I'd like to bring another perspective to this. I'm Henry Vines, and I live at 3450 Isley Drive in Snow Camp. It's in the country. I've lived there for over 45 years. Ladies and gentlemen, there's noises that's in the county, that's in the country. This is the country that we're proposing to put an ordinance on. Yes, there's noises that I don't like in the country, right in my own neighborhood, within a quarter to half a mile. A screaming peacock. I don't like it, but I put up with it. A donkey screaming like a bugle that you never heard of anything else. Mm-hmm. These are sounds that are country. These are sounds that are going to be governed. Y'all going to have to go up and tell my neighbor he's got to get rid of his peacock. He's got to get rid of his rooster because I don't want to hear it crowing in the morning. My daughter, she don't like that peacock hollering, so she can call. Look, folks, this is serious. When we start trying to regulate, or as we ugly words say, zone the county with ordinances, and as the speakers have spoke about the exemptions, I appreciate the fact that farming is exempt. But when you start taking out one exemption, then the next folks is going to come and take out one another one taken out. What are we going to do? Put the farmers out of business. So when we start attacking each other in our own neighborhoods, it creates a problem. It creates a problem for our sheriff's department. You know, who's going to determine as what is excessive? I mean, what's obnoxious to you may not be obnoxious to me. This dog's running out through the woods at night chasing coons. They're not hunting, but there's people that love to hear those dogs holler. Not my favorite thing. But these are country sounds. A cow hollering at night, you know, a bobcat screaming. These are just things that we live with. And to take this out of the country, when we have people that are coming out here and making these developments, and they're wanting to have city life in the country. If you're going to come to the country, be part of us. Don't be against us. You know, we've been there for years. There's somebody that's been there 100 years, and they cherish their time. They like to hear that rooster crowing in the morning. So I'd appreciate it if y'all would reconsider this, because I think it's too far-reaching.
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you so much. All right, that ends our agenda-related public speakers. Do we have any commissioner responses this time?
No, I think we're going to talk about it later, aren't we?
Yeah.
Okay.
Save the remarks about the noise ordinance for later. So those are all agenda-related. But the one thing Mr. Reed did bring up about the Board of Elections resolution, and that is part of our consent agenda, which we're almost ready to vote on. So if everyone has had the opportunity to review the agenda, if we could have a motion for approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion, a second, to approve the agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Then we have the consent agenda as presented. I would need to delete letter C, donation of surplus vehicles from the sheriff's office. We're going to work on transferring that to May the 6th because that item has to be advertised. So if you would delete C, donation of surplus vehicles, sheriff's office, if we could have a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
So motion.
Okay.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda as amended. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. So the next thing is talking about our board appointee evaluation process. And I made a note to myself that we would spend no more, hopefully much less, but no more than 15 minutes talking about this. So it's call it 7:35. Sherry Hooks has got some information for us. And as she's handing that out, this has been my suggestion that we undertake a evaluation process for the people who directly report to the Board of Commissioners. We have four employees of the county who report directly to the Board of Commissioners: the county manager, the county clerk, the county attorney, and our tax administrator. And is the tax administrator in here? If we could get him from the other end so he can be in here while we're talking about it. So it came to my attention when we were talking about merit raises last year that the merit raise process leaves out these four people, because the merit raises, I think, were determined by the supervisor of the person, the county employee, and since these people, their supervisor didn't evaluate them, they were left out of that process. Also, I think that it's good for us to have a process whereby our direct reports can receive feedback about things that they're doing which are positive and be, you know, have that reinforced, and maybe think areas where they could find some improvement. I think it increases our professionalism as a board, and I think it's been quite some time since the job descriptions were reviewed. And so that's why I suggested that we undertake this process. As part of it, I have had an opportunity to talk to commissioners from other counties about the process and how they do it. Sherry, did you have a presentation you wanted to make about that?
I just have a few things about the things that I handed out tonight. Okay, so the big packet that you see with the green sheet on top, that is just job descriptions from other counties for the four positions that we've talked about. The small packet has in it several things. It has current job descriptions, although they're not current, for the four positions. And it has the PM goals from last fiscal year, also this fiscal year, for each of those positions. And it has a chart in here that is a comparison chart that shows the four positions and the salaries, years in office, for some other counties of comparable positions. Just a couple of things to note in there. When you look at county attorney, the six counties that I contacted, not all of those actually employ a county attorney. Some of those have those on retainer, so you'll see that information in there. Clerk to the board, there's a little bit more information just because we did go through the process recently to update that job description, so the one in there is current. The other things that I would point out is that I did include a performance review form that we use for department heads, which is something that the board can decide if they want to use this form, or in the past reviews have been done a little less formally and have just been summarized in the form of a memo to the employee's file. So the board can decide whether they want to do that or not, how they want to document. And then, so that's documentation of feedback. The board may want to decide how they want to gather feedback, and then also how they're going to review that with the employee, whether that's going to be with the whole board in closed session or with just one or two board members outside of a commissioner's meeting. So just things to think about. And that's that last page in that small handout. And that's all that I really had.
Great, thank you. I've had the opportunity to talk to commissioners from three other counties to ask them what they did. I talked to Alan Branson from Guilford County. He said they're not doing anything either. They're at the same place that we are. I spoke with Richard Helms from Union County. He has served as chair in the past, and he said that he collects evaluations from the Board of Commissioners, so the other commissioners fill out the evaluation form, and then the chair and the vice chair of the board go over those evaluations with the direct report. In Rockingham County, they collect evaluations from the Board of Commissioners in the same way, but then they meet and they discuss them as a group in closed session, and then the chair reviews the results of that discussion with the employee. And so, I guess the good way to proceed right now would be to ask, while y'all think about that, to look at the job descriptions for the positions and ask y'all when you, so I understand that the our direct reports have had the opportunity to review their job descriptions. Mr. Hager, when you looked at the job description for the county manager, was there anything in here that you thought either you don't do, so it should be taken out, or is there anything that you thought you actually do that's not in there that needs to be added?
Commissioners, it seemed to me the manager's job description is pretty broad, and that can be good at some points because this position is pretty wide open. There's lots of different things that come the manager's way. I did think that it might be worth considering under the part about presenting to the county commissioners an annual operating budget. I have spent a lot of time over the past 2 years on capital too, examining our capital and making, and we're also responsible for schools and ACC capital, as we all know. So there might be some value to actually pointing out that the manager has a function to make sure the commissioners have a plan for capital improvements. This doesn't happen all the time, but when it happens, it's a mad scramble among a lot of us. It's economic development projects. I don't think it really touched on ED. It is not the manager's total sole responsibility, but I wind up as the manager providing information. Yes. And there's a lot of people working on that besides just me, but that might be something for the other, particularly for Clyde, I think, maybe, because he's a key part of that too.
Yeah, right.
And then there's just general reports that we prepare now, financial information and updates about how the county's doing financially. So, I mean, those are just a few suggestions to consider to be a little more specific, perhaps. Otherwise, I thought it was pretty accurate. Again, as I say, it's broad, but there's some value in that too.
Okay, that's really good insight, I think. Does anybody have any comments they want to make about adding those items to the county manager's job description?
I think definitely the economic development part, because he is somewhat, he and Clyde, I know, share that, but ultimately it comes to Brian to bring back to us to work with.
There's an element of coordination,
yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You collaborate with county attorney, collaborate or coordinate with county attorney and others.
Other like, managers, yes.
Yeah, and the our economic development officer, who's, I guess, the Chamber of Commerce. Okay. So we can add those things and amend that. Do y'all have any
sure.
other thoughts? Sure.
I'm in favor of that.
Me too.
And I thought that was a good point about the capital improvements, because mm-hmm. you do a lot of that. That's
yeah,
for sure.
That's for sure.
That's one of the reasons we like
it. We fell into that.
Okay. Well, great. So there's nothing to delete.
I don't think so.
I think
okay, so we'll look at amending that. All right, Mr. Albright, did you have anything that you saw?
Well, the North Carolina statute 153A114 simply says that I'm appointed to be your legal advisor. The property tax commission rules say I am appointed as your counsel for matters before the property tax commission. And the tax administrator and I work on those type cases. In fact, we just settled two big ones last week. But we go down, it's a jury trial with five judges, the property tax commission. It's not a huge part of my job, but it's a very important part of our job because that brings the funding into the county. And usually it's big businesses that contest.
What was that statute?
It's the North Carolina Property Tax Commission rules.
So that's not in here?
I don't have
it's
the
not.
Statute.
Yeah, it's
statute.
I can look it up, but it's not in the. It's not in my job description.
Yeah,
but I do work with.
That's an important part of this operation.
So it's the revenue generator.
The North Carolina Property Tax
Commission. Yes. And the tax administrator and I also work together on the economic development end when we're deciding on how much of a grant we are going to extend to someone. And then he follows up at the end of the grant period to make sure they have employed the number of people and have made the appropriate number of investments. So he and I both look at those type things. But that's other than that, it's a general practice with a client with a lot of problems. That's what my job is.
That doesn't hurt.
And you're licensed to practice in the state of North Carolina. You've always got to be current, right?
I am. That's a good thing.
I have one question that in the job description here, it says, serves as legal counsel for the Industrial Revenue Bond Authority. Is that something you still do?
We still have some of those reports we have to file, believe it or not, annually. Even though I don't think we've had an industrial revenue bond here. I think the last one I was involved with was when I was in-house counsel for Cone Mills, and we did one for the Hall River plant for Cone Mills back in the 80s. That's something that's not done, but they ask you to follow up and report on that.
Okay. So you would suggest we add something about you're representing the county of the North Carolina Properties Tax Commission, and then a bullet like we have with Brian for the economic development piece.
Yes.
And working on that. Is there anything else?
That takes care of it. Thank you.
Okay. Great. Y'all have any, is there any discussion about that? Okay. Mr. Akins, I assume that we're going to add the same thing about economic development for you.
I will gladly borrow from Clyde. Well, the description is written very broadly, so I just kind of grouped it in, but I like the specific reference.
And was there anything in your description about the going to the Property Tax Commission?
I don't know that it's in there specifically. Again, it's written very broadly.
So okay, we'll make a note of that, and if it's not in there, we'll make sure it's in there. Does anybody, is there any discussion about that? The board? Okay, Tori, Ms. Frank?
I have several items to add. In the current description, it looks like there might have been some duplications. But some key responsibilities were definitely left out.
Okay.
And I have a list of those if you want me to send up the list or if you want me to read them all.
That's a long list, Tori.
In the interest of time, do you think that... why don't we just take a look at that?
You want it now?
Wait, would you hand it out to the board and then... Do you have copies for everybody?
No.
If we can get copies for everybody and hand them out to the board, then that would be great. And then we can have those to review and take a look at. So, what do y'all think, though, about the process? What kind of model do y'all feel like you favor? Do you feel like you favor collecting evaluations from the board and then discuss them in closed session and then either the chair or somebody designated by the board reviewing them with the employee, or do you favor collecting evaluations from the board and then the chair and the vice chair?
Speaking for myself, if there's somebody I'm meeting with these people, I want to be part of it. I think everybody, all the commissioners are responsible.
So you'd rather do it in a closed session with all commissioners?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Behind closed doors where we can talk to them.
Awesome. Well, if that's the general consensus, then that's what we'll do. That makes perfect sense to me. All right, well, we have about 2 minutes left in my 15-minute time slot. Does anybody else have any concerns or anything they want to talk about with that item? Then we'll take a look at the evaluation form, and I guess we'll just kind of figure that out. We'll look at the form and... come up with one that we feel like works, and if y'all see the form and you don't like it, then we'll address that at that time. Okay, then we'll move on to the next item on the agenda, which is the noise ordinance discussion. Great. So, I guess, Mr. Albright, would you lead us in the discussing the noise ordinance, kind of go over the changes that are in the draft that was in the agenda packet, please.
Yes. I would like to start by saying this began with an effort on the sheriff's part to put some time periods, to use his words, put some teeth into the ordinance. He felt like having time periods blocked off would better enable him to enforce the Alamance County noise ordinance. Now, we made 6 changes to the ordinance, and listening to the comments tonight, I feel like it's probably a good thing to review them. In Section 6, we added the time period. And remember, we're talking about unreasonably loud, disturbing, and unnecessary noise in the county, including but in no way limited to times from 10 p.m. to 7 a.m. on weekdays, and until 10 p.m. till 9 a.m. on Saturday, and any time before 12:30 on Sunday. And we repeat that in at the end of the change to the ordinance. On page 4, we have added an exemption for bona fide hunting activity consistent with North Carolina law. We've added exemption 16, shooting ranges organized for the promotion of safe hunting and shooting practices operating between the hours of sunrise and sunset, except that the hours may be extended after sunset for purposes of subdued lighting certification for law enforcement officers or for such other purposes when a permit is issued by the Sheriff's Department. On Sunday, shooting shall not commence before 12:30. That was change 4 and 5. On the second page, we added the time periods as part of the factors. Up at the top of the page, the following factors incident to a noise are to be considered: the time of day, which is what the sheriff wanted us to spell out, 10 p.m. to 7 a.m. on weekdays, 10 p.m. till 9 a.m. on weekends. Second factor is proximity to residential structures, whether noise is recurrent, whether it's intermittent or constant, the volume and intensity of the noise, whether the noise has been enhanced in the volume by electronic means, the character of the area, whether the noise is related to the operation of a business or other labor activity. These are the type of things, we just put the time period in there to, as the sheriff says, give the thing some teeth. The third change we did...
Can we go back to that one just a second? Would that not need to, if you're going to specify a time period on page 1 on Sundays, would that not be need to be included on this item on page 2?
We put that down at 15. We added 15 to page 3. That talks about firing weapons on weekdays and Saturdays and any time before 12:30 on Sunday. In close proximity to residential structures. Those are the changes that we've made to the existing ordinance. The penalty section is change number 6. It's on page 5. It spells out that if you violate the ordinance, it's a class 3 misdemeanor, and the sheriff will write you a ticket. After he gives you an initial written warning, he comes out there again, same house, same complaint, same time of night, he'll give you a ticket. And that spells out what the citations will cost you. So that's where we stand. I looked at the Forsyth County ordinance. Forsyth County has a provision in their ordinance which makes it unlawful to discharge a firearm within 300 feet of an occupied residence. So I don't think we want to go that far.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
Well, I'm just pointing out, we haven't gone that far to getting tape measures and measuring. But from what I heard and you heard from the citizens, these things aren't widespread. There's one or two incidences where you have somebody maybe not mindful of his neighbor discharging his weapon. And I've lived in the country and I've heard these things, especially during opening day, dove season. You hear them all over the place. And that's part of living in the country. But what this tries to do is address unreasonable, loud, disturbing noises. And what we've done is put the time period in at the suggestion of the sheriff. That's where we find ourselves this evening.
What about the number? Let's see, it's section 7, exemptions. Number 14, normal sounds associated with or customary to industrial manufacturing operations in the normal course of business, mm-hmm. provided that said businesses are operating in a lawful manner.
Right.
Can we exclude industry, heavy industrial
Well, if you want to take that out, you need to look at number two in that exemption list. Regularly scheduled events at commercial racetracks, speedways, or drag strips. Number three, farming operations. That's a business. Most of them today are businesses. Number 10, noise from sanitation operations.
Right, but those aren't, excuse me for interrupting, but those aren't industrial manufacturing operations.
But those are all businesses.
Right, but they're not industrial. So I'm sorry, I'm not following you. How if we were to remove number 14, normal sounds associated with industrial manufacturing operations, and held them to the same noise standards as everybody else, but we left in the racetrack, the farming operations.
Well, the last part of 14 talks about providing that they're operated in a lawful manner. So if Buckner Steel is working late to meet an order and he's operating his business in a lawful manner, are you going to tell him he's got to stop, and how are you going to enforce that?
Would Buckner Steel not be grandfathered out of this noise ordinance? If that's their customary business and the people...
This deals with unreasonably loud noises. The definition section defines it as a unnecessary noise, unreasonably loud. And steel manufacturing, any type of industry out in the county, it's going to have periods of time where it's unreasonably loud. A paint shop. I used to work in a paint shop. When that air compressor kicks in, it's very loud. So if you're doing body shop work at night, I mean, you're going to shut them down? And there are body shops out in the country. We've gone far afield from what the sheriff asked to address gunfire calls.
Right, but we're also, I mean, these people have come in and asking us to address another problem at the same time, but I mean, is Buckner Steel operating between after 10 o'clock on weekdays and before 7 o'clock in the morning? We haven't heard them come in and voice any concerns about that or anybody else.
I do remember one time we did have an issue with a galvanizing plant.
Mm-hmm.
The neighborhood was fussing about that, but as you say, the ordinance covered them operating trucks, unloading, moving steel at night, so. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how that would affect.
Are we still in the moratorium period?
Yes, we are, and that's a good question. We have an update about the moratorium and the process of revising the HIDO.
Which how much time's left in that?
June 3rd.
Yeah.
Beg your pardon?
June 3rd is when the moratorium ends on the heavy industry development.
Well, I have to say, I'm not real happy with not being able to limit sounds from businesses. I mean, I know we have a number of citizens down in the snow camp area that are very concerned about the potential noise being coming from that mining operation. And I just don't think we ought to give them carte blanche to do whatever they want to do. Up to this point, everything they've tried to do has been very clandestine. And I just don't know that we have any idea how they're going to operate when they get started. I mean, we wouldn't have even found out about this if it hadn't been for people coming to us telling about it. So, and I'm not extremely happy with putting limitations on firearms. I mean, I don't want somebody shooting over my head or anybody else's head, as we've heard. I mean, that's not safe. That's a whole different issue from the noise.
But, yeah, actually, I had a gentleman ask me that runs the Lakeview Turkey Shoot. How does that affect them? Because they finish up normally at 10, but occasionally they may run over to 11.
Right.
And, therefore, you've got gunfire.
I know Clyde's put a lot of time into this, and I appreciate your efforts. I'm really struggling with what we need to do here. I mean, I can't count the calls in the last week or so, and emails, and a lot of you guys have seen some of the same emails I've seen. So.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the gun issue was not necessarily to limit people's rights to go shoot guns. When you have a gentleman here talking about somebody shooting a gun, he hears the bullets zinging over his head and he's scared to go work on his fence on his 100 acres because the guy's got an acre next door and he's shooting his way. I don't know that we can regulate that, though, from an ordinance, because that's, I mean, that's endangering somebody. I mean, there are laws against that.
You could file a criminal complaint.
Right.
Probably what I'll do in that situation.
Because it's not the ranges that are, we hadn't heard the problem from the range, you know, the gentleman.
Yeah, I haven't heard any complaints.
You know, you haven't heard that complaint.
I haven't heard a complaint.
Because these are organized groups that are actually doing what they should. It would be nice if everybody took some notes and went to their range and shot and did things appropriate. So I don't know.
We had a speaker from Central Carolina and from Durham Rifle and Gun, and I think Central Carolina has some lighted ranges. I know we do at Alamance Wildlife, and you know, we don't regularly have events where we're shooting at 9 or 10 o'clock at night, but it's lit so that people can shoot. But I don't know that we ever had any complaints about it. I know people have told me, I have some friends that live on the other side of them mountain from our gun club, and they've said they can hear some shooting, but they've never complained about it. So,
well, I think number one, you got a moratorium. I think we need to spend some professional time getting a professional ordinance rather than a seat of the britches, knee-jerk reaction thrown together, forgive me, copies of what other counties are doing. That's how we got this mess to start with. Not blaming you, but that's how we got in this mess. Now, as far as the guns go, the guy that stood right here, it started it all. He moved in here from Orange County, lives down on the Chapel Hill side of the our line. He just don't like guns, period. He said they shot 11 o'clock that day. He liked that.
Right. And we can't regulate that. Yeah.
And then you had two other people come in here from Raleigh that live here. They don't like it. Had another guy come in here from California. He didn't like it. I don't know that we had one native that said they didn't like it. Might have had one. But
well, we had two or three that actually brought it to our attention.
Well, yeah, you had one guy say he had a hole in his window, but he didn't know if it came from a bullet or not. My gosh. That could have come from a thrown rock from the driveway. You know, I just think we've had a knee-jerk reaction on this whole thing. And you've admitted that we're the only county that had ours, period. And you've admitted that you thought that our ordinance had enough teeth in it for the sheriff to do what he needed to do.
That's right.
You've said that. I believe that. And I just will not vote for ours, period, on
guns. I'll make a motion that we table.
That's fine with me. I'll make it.
I'll second it.
If not, just turning it down altogether. But tabling it, if it doesn't come back up, it's fine. But I'll make the motion.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to table it, but I think that there's still discussion to be had about it, because I would like to know, Mr. Albright, your opinion about some of the emails that we got brought up, Chapter 14-409.46, which is sports shooting range protection, that goes on to say that you can't regulate sports shooting ranges through noise ordinances, and then that defines a sports shooting range as an area designed and operated for the use of rifles, shotguns, pistols, and stuff like that. And then a person is an individual, proprietorship, partnership. So my question is, if a person is an individual who is target practicing in their backyard and has set up some kind of place that they consider to be a sport range, even if it doesn't have a berm, but that's where they commonly practice their sport shooting, can we, through a noise ordinance, regulate that activity if we have this statute that says that like a person who owns, operates, uses a sports shooting range is not subject to an action for nuisance on the basis of noise and noise pollution, and then not be subject to criminal liability or criminal prosecution in any matter relating to noise or noise pollution if the range is in compliance, that with any noise control laws, ordinances that applied to the range and its operation at the time the range began operation. So for these people who are target practicing in the backyard and are in the habit of doing that, would this noise ordinance apply to them?
The current noise ordinance deals with unreasonably loud and unnecessary and disturbing noises. Depends on who your neighbor is. If you're out there and you're target practicing with a little 22 on a Saturday afternoon, it's different from firing a Bushmaster or 30-06 at 11 o'clock at night. The volume, intensity, and time are the issues. So I think that's fine if they want to have their own target range, but you got to be careful and have a proper berm and safety. Bullets go a long way.
They sure do.
And if they want that liability, that's fine. But even with that business, we're talking about operating it in a lawful manner. Because most people put up with a lot from their neighbors. But when it becomes unreasonable, that's when they get angry and call the sheriff. And most people, it has to really get bad for that to happen. My experience, my personal experience. And the ordinance as it's written right now will cover that. If you continuously get calls about a neighbor, and I'll give an example. A neighbor calling about his neighbor's dog barking. The deputy went out there numerous times, the dog was barking. So the deputy pulled up where he could see the neighbor's house. Early one morning, he sat there and watched. The neighbor got out with a rake handle and went up and down the fence.
Provoking.
Agitated the dog. And the dog, dog started barking. And then he gets the call on his radio, a noise disturbance. I'm not saying that happens all the time, but it does happen.
Neighbors will do that.
Some will. They antagonize their neighbor. But getting back to your question, the ordinance that you have now, if you don't amend anything, I think it's a viable and enforceable ordinance.
Item 14 reads as it reads in the current ordinance.
We added
exemptions.
We added 14 and let me see. 14 in the old ordinance said normal sounds associated with customary or industrial manufacturing operations. We added 15. Bona fide hunting, we added 16 shooting ranges as exemptions.
However, you do have, they can't commence before 12:30 on Sunday, though.
Well, you can change that time. You so desire.
Well, we have a motion and a second to table it. I'm going to say that I'm going to vote against that because I think that we should, even though I appreciate Mr. Sutton's comment that these things can, that the heavy industry can be dealt with through the revision of the HIDO, I think that if the unreasonable and excessive standard is going to apply, then that would be something that could also apply to industry as well. So. That's my stance on that. Does anybody else have any comments?
I think we're dealing with such a mixed bag here. I agree with you on that issue with the business noise. And, if we table it and we don't do anything about it, we haven't accomplished anything for anybody. We've already spent a lot of time on it, but.
I need somebody to tell me what we're limiting, please.
Beg your pardon?
I need somebody to tell me what we're limiting.
The noise of the shooting.
Well, I think I'm specifically referring to the noise from industry, especially heavy industry. But you're talking about what are we? You're talking about the shooting.
I'm just not willing to vote for hours that limit shooting.
Period. Well, and that's where the amendments are, because right here it is. We're already subject to the
unreasonable.
That goes out, I mean, I don't.
Right, so you're, okay.
Well, I mean, I agree with that. I agree that if our county attorney says that the ordinance as it stands, the original ordinance as it stands is adequate to preserve the sanctity of people in their homes and in their backyards, then I'm fine with that. I just would like to see us do something to prevent industry from.
Okay, I'm all for that.
I'm fine too, yeah.
I don't want through the back door or front door or window or attic.
Firearm.
Knock something else out. I mean, that's my point.
Yeah.
And basically, the time is really what was addressing the firearm issue.
So, do you want to withdraw your motion to table?
Well, I don't want to vote for hours, so you tell me what I need to do. I'm not much of a motion person. Y'all know that. I don't make many.
Let's make some amendments to the. If you were willing to withdraw your motion, we could discuss some amendments to this ordinance.
Okay, I withdraw.
Okay, thank you. I would suggest that we consider a motion that would adopt the ordinance, the original ordinance, with the change, the sole change being that we remove Section 7 exemptions number 14, and thereby, let's discuss it some more, and thereby industrial and manufacturing operations subject to the same standard of unreasonable noise disturbance or unreasonably loud noise.
Curious to see what Clyde thinks about that.
Well, the way it's written out, it talks about normal sounds associated with or customary to industrial or manufacturing operations. Now, I don't know how you eliminate that. A normal sound associated with industrial or manufacturing. Unless you're going to eliminate manufacturing. I don't know that that's enforceable.
Will you be eliminating the abnormal manufacturing?
Well,
excessive.
It talks about operating those businesses in a lawful manner. If you're operating in an unlawful manner, if you're exceedingly loud, you take the muffling devices off your bulldozer engines to get more power and save more fuel, doubling the sound, those type things.
How about blasting? I mean, the quarry we know will be blasting. Is there, where's the law on that?
Can I don't know
do that
how you,
at 12 o'clock at night?
Can we have stop the blasting between hours?
I don't know how you muffle it.
I mean, I'm asking, is there something in the law that says that they cannot do that? That's not a lawful part of an operation at midnight at night to go blast.
Well, I can certainly look at that. I don't think they're going to be blasting at night. I would hope they wouldn't be blasting.
Well, they said they're going to operate 24 hours a day.
Right, and if they are, they have that option if it's not unlawful.
Well, we can explore that. I don't know what their time periods or how much they do. I don't know if they blast once a week or once a day or twice a day. I don't know. But if it's a normal procedure to, and they don't use dynamite, they drill a hole in the ground, they pump some type of goo
in there, yeah.
And they do a more scientific blast.
Still makes a big noise.
Right. To try and measure the results of that. From what I know about it, I'm no expert on it, but just what I've read through this exercise. But when you talk about eliminating noises from business, I think that's a slippery slope. Where does that end? Every business I've been associated with makes noise, whether it's a forklift truck or a warehouse door slamming shut or opening or air compressors or whatever. And the quarry, I would remind the board, is supposed to be 2,000 feet away from residential operations, residences. The spacing requirement, their center of operation is 2,000 feet. That's a pretty good distance, and they've got to have berms and buffers to eliminate the noise problem. Just things to consider before you take that out.
I would think in a moratorium, I understand what helped the situation. I honestly do. Like I say, the whole thing got botched, and we're paying the price for it, and they are too. But going forward, I thought the moratorium was to give us time to get a professional approach to this.
Yes, for right. the for the industrial development ordinance.
Business side, the industrial side. We kind of end up with a combination here.
And what's happened with this is we started with the sheriff asking for time periods to control unreasonable noise, and it sort of morphed into, let's eliminate the rock quarry with the noise ordinance. And I think that's a bad way to use the noise.
Well, if you're saying we have enough teeth in this for the sheriff to do his job, I know he said he didn't, but how about leaving the penalty side in for those unreasonable, unquestionable things that are dangerous to others that they're doing?
He was wanting the teeth, that was.
Well, I think that's a good suggestion, because we've added a section in that talks about an initial written warning.
Right.
And nothing says I'm thinking a lot of you than that first citation when you get invited to court.
Right. Just to get their attention and say, you know, we've been parked over here and we're hearing you blasting whatever you're blasting and doing this, that, and the other. And it's pretty unreasonable.
Okay, so what we'd be doing is we sort of bring it all in. Section 1 title is the same. Section 2 purpose, prohibit unreasonable. That word unreasonable in red is added. And so keep that maybe.
Right.
And the S in freedoms. And then not keep in the Section 6 sub A with the time limits. Not include that.
Scratch all the,
And scratch all, on page 2, scratch all those time limits. And scratch the and at the end of number 14 and scratch number 15 under Section 6. All this stuff having to do with the firing of weapons.
Right.
Was there a reason for that 3 and number 1 under Section 7?
Sound emanating from regularly scheduled with the little 3 there. Is that a typo?
I'm sorry, which did you refer to?
It's paragraph 1 under Section 7. Right in the middle of it, there's a 3.
That's the page number that I couldn't get to drop off.
That's page number.
I'm not smart enough.
Page 2.
Okay.
Page 2.
Schedule 3. Page 3. He didn't have enough margin there to make all that work.
Okay, and I think I understand what Mr. Albright's saying about the normal course of business for number 14. Number 15, bona fide hunting activity consistent with North Carolina law. I like that. I would like to see us.
That's already state law, too. So.
Right, that just stays.
So we'll leave that?
You want to leave that in?
That's no time limits. That's just consistent with North Carolina law.
Hunting in North Carolina literally can be 24 hours a day.
Yes.
Because you can hunt.
Coyote and so forth at night.
Coyotes and bobcats 24 hours a day.
See all the foxes that are running around here?
7 days a week.
I saw a fox.
It was cute. So me, you're running over them.
It looked like a cat with big ears. Number 16, the shooting ranges. We're going to get rid of that, right?
Yeah, no time limits.
And then complaint procedure and enforcement. The penalties. We want to keep the penalties, right?
Yes.
Right.
You want to get rid of 16?
16. We'll just, because it's got a time.
Okay.
Scratch number 16. And then the penalties, though. We want to keep all the part in section number 9. Is that right?
Yes.
So that'll be the teeth in it that weren't there before.
I'll make the changes and get them to you.
So we'll be seeking, I guess, a motion to approve the changes to the noise ordinance as just
amended. I'll make a motion that we do that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve those changes in the noise ordinance. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. Thank you. Dr. Thorpe, Dr. Todd Thorpe, has got some requests from ADSS.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
I shall be brief, I think. I first come to you asking for a lottery fund request for summer work. You've seen this list before. We do have about $1.8 million of traditional work, and then we have the $447,000 for the CTEC debt services, $2.257 million.
And a lot of those are painting, I think, right?
Painting. We're still on our rounds of painting. We've got about, I think, three or four more years of a painting will be one time all the way around.
What kind of abatement did you have at Broadview?
With Broadview, we got carpet in the media, and everything tests hot underneath it, especially the mastic. So we know we're going to have to abate.
It's expensive.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It almost doubles the price of the job.
Okay.
You might want to make a motion.
I'll make a motion that we approve this
one. Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the ABSS lottery fund request. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. Got a capital funding request?
School capital reserve funds, $1.2 million to finish the last three roofing projects that we have at E.M. Holt, Graham Middle School, and Sellers Gun.
May I have any questions?
Todd's telling me some of the roofs held up under all this rain, so we're doing
good,
right?
Yes, sir. We stayed dry Friday. That was a good sign in some of them.
Yes.
3 inches in our house.
I've got a video of water coming back out of the storm drain at Turntine. It came so hard it came back up in the building.
Wow.
So we had to spend several hours getting it cleaned up.
How much did we approve it?
Second.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. I have a motion and a second to approve their capital funding request. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, lottery completed projects.
And the last thing is, as I've told you before, my goal is to bring projects in under budget as close as they're, bring them in budget or under budget as close as I can. I have about $235,000 to return back to our lottery funds to either pay on this next run or for the next time we need money for a lottery.
Move we approve it.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second for approval. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure.
Mr. Haygood? We'll do the next three items and then we'll take a recess.
Well, thank you, Commissioners. Good evening. I have three items for you to consider this evening. They are all three pertaining to the proposed bond projects for the school system and community college. What we're asking the commissioners to consider is approving reimbursement resolutions for both entities, ABSS and ACC. These reimbursement resolutions, this first one is for the Alamance-Pendleton school system, pertains to their bond projects. What we're asking the commissioners to do is to give permission to advance the school system $3 million from Alamance County. The school system would use these funds for design work and upfront costs for their proposed bond projects. If we approve these funds now, the school system has access to them. They're able to start their design work, and this will keep them on the project schedule that is in the capital plan. The county will be repaid from ABSS for the money that we're going to front to the school system. We would be repaid for the first debt issuance that is proposed to be done in May of 2020. And the school system would be able to start spending this money, this upfront funding, immediately. But the bonds will not be approved until you vote to do so, particularly our plan right now is to make that a part of this budget process. So this is not approving the bonds, but this is fronting money for the school system to go ahead and get started on their design work and their upfront costs. So these funds, this $3 million, would the county would pay that from our unassigned fund balance, which we are estimating after, if the board votes to approve all three of these reimbursement resolutions, our unassigned fund balance would be $14.9 million approximately. So that is taking it down. The good news is we would get this money back. It would take, approving all three of these will take us down to $14.9 million unassigned fund balance. That's our free and clear do what we want to with money. So, but it does take three separate actions. So the first one is a $3 million reimbursement resolution for Alamance-Pendleton school system.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that bond reimbursement resolution. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you. The second resolution is for Alamance Community College, and this is very similar. We're requesting the board approve a reimbursement resolution, and this particular one pertains to the community college's proposed parking deck bond project. The total for proposed cost for the parking deck is 8 $1,460,000. We are requesting permission to advance the community college $587,961 from Alamance County. Again, these would be used by the college for design and upfront costs for this project. If we approve it, keeps the community college on schedule for the parking deck project, and the county would be repaid from the first debt issuance in May of 2020. College will start spending this money, or they'd be authorized to spend this money immediately. And again, our unassigned fund balance will still be, if you approve all of these, $14.9 million.
How many levels is that garage?
We don't know yet. Got to get somebody to design it.
I think we have, say Cindy's in the overflow room?
Yeah, Cindy can.
Mr. Boswell is the board of trustees.
Well, that's what we're kind of needing, is the money to have somebody design it. So it's not 100%.
You have 8 million, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
They were talking 8, I think. But
eight
floors.
Perhaps Cindy could come up and answer that question for us.
Depends on where they put it. You know, make a lot more than that. There's a couple questions on that. No, that's good. Good, that's good.
8 floors awful high, isn't it?
Depends on where down there where they put it.
Yeah.
If they put it in a hole, they may not have
the. I don't have a problem with it.
Yeah, and she doesn't know actually what the total number is, do you?
Right now, the tentative plan is 4 to 5 levels.
Yeah. 4 to 5. Okay, that's more.
400 spaces.
Yeah.
Okay.
400 spaces is what we're at. Depends on where we put it, though.
Right.
Some, you know, that will determine.
Exactly.
Can I get you to assure me that if we that you build it strong enough that you can add a floor?
We can definitely talk.
Please talk to them about
to the
that.
Architect about that.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And also the center of isn't part of this with the Center of Excellent Design.
Right, and that's, I believe,
it's not mentioned in this.
It's the next one.
Oh, you're
yes,
okay. We're doing
we
it separate. I'm sorry.
Right.
I got a question about adding a floor, though. Now, Bill, if they you're eliminating with some of the other buildings that are in this bond, you're eliminating some existing parking space.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So
a lot of expensive
parking. If you go in and add a floor, then you will. The process of adding a floor is going to shut down at least one level of that parking garage while you're adding a floor.
Right.
So you'll be eliminating parking spaces again. So a good idea is if you think you're going to need more, build it now instead of building less.
It's a lot cheaper to put it in there as you go.
Right.
That's right.
The parking deck actually is taking the place of part of the footage on the campus that's going to be used in buildings.
Right.
Actually, the parking will be better once you get 400 spaces.
Yes.
Definitely.
The Center of Excellence and the Student Services Center will wipe out a significant number of parking spaces, and we're already almost maxed out at parking. So.
Thank you.
Okay. Just hang out, Cindy. We may have another question.
Thank you, sir.
To make a note, do we have a motion and a second on this item already?
I'll make a motion.
Second.
Okay, we do now. Motion and a second to adopt this bond reimbursement resolution. Is there more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right.
The final reimbursement resolution, again, is for the community college, and this is for the Center of Excellence bond project that's proposed. The total proposed cost for the Center of Excellence is $9.1 million, and we're requesting to be able to advance the community college $649,648 from the county, again, for design and upfront costs. And we would be looking, the county would be looking to be repaid from the debt issuance that would occur possibly in May of 2020, but definitely in the debt issuance of September 2020. So it would be in one of those two issuances. So all the rest of the details are the same. This would be coming from unassigned fund balance.
And Cindy, you may want to explain why these projects seem to have moved up the ladder in the construction process. Why the parking deck got moved up to the top of the ladder.
Just as we were discussing just a minute ago, building the Center of Excellence and the Student Services Center is going to take up so much existing parking, and we're almost at a maximum. So when we went back and evaluated the projects, it just made sense. Let's go ahead and build the parking deck. And also, when the Center of Excellence and the Student Services Center are construction sites, even more parking will not be available.
Right.
So if we can go ahead, get that parking deck up, we'll have available parking and keep everything running more smoothly and efficiently.
And both of these are going to be put out on request for proposal as pretty much like one project.
Yes, yes. Center of Excellence and parking deck go together. Wednesday.
Yeah.
We're going to put it out Wednesday.
I do have a question. I brought up the issue of leasing versus building and ownership. Has ACC considered perhaps leasing a parking garage? Leasing any of these facilities, having to build a suit?
Mm-hmm. We have looked at that, and we'll continue to look at that, especially for our satellite locations, leasing space and updating space.
I think the college brought in Kenan Briggs to talk about the different methods the college could use, and I attended that board of trustee meeting, did an excellent job. I think the college has pretty much come down on most of the methods that they're interested in using for these projects. So it was an excellent presentation. A lot of good information.
But it was not what Steve's talking about, leasing, like say Samet build it or some company build it and lease it back. No,
I wouldn't think that would go.
We've not
go
done that.
Not yet.
I'm not in favor of that.
We haven't. So.
Okay. We need a motion.
So moved.
Approve that resolution.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that reimbursement resolution. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, thank you. Let's have a brief recess, about 10 minutes, please. All right, thank you. Mr. Haygood, you have some budget information for us.
I do, Commissioners. I have some information to cover with the board. I'm going to give you hard copies, too. So you can follow along. This is a hard copy of the PowerPoint presentation that I'm preparing to go through. And it's also a hard copy of the each department's information that's included in your packet. But I'm going to be sure you have this in front of you as we go through this. So presentation and the information from the packets. So I'm going to go over kind of a general overview of the county government's budget requests that have come in thus far from departments and outside agencies and the education groups. And if you have detailed questions, those are in the bound copy for each department. So you can look at those tonight as I go through this information or later on. And if you have any questions, you can let me know. We have all department heads are here this evening, either here or in the overflow room, and they're prepared to answer any questions that you might have. And then I'm going to, at a point, I'm going to call on a couple of our larger departments, Health and DSS, just to make sure I'm covering everything that they need to communicate to you. This is the department's opportunity to communicate to you and to me their needs. Again, as you look at this information, this is the information that we'll be working with to balance the fiscal year 19-20 budget. So this is not a balanced budget. Obviously, this is requests and good information to go over. So I'm going to go ahead and get started with no further ado. This is a lot of information to cover. I'm going to go through it as quickly as I can, but try to be thorough. But if at any point you have questions for me, or if you see something that piques your interest that you want to ask a department head, this is your opportunity. I'm going to be listening for your comments and your concerns, and if you're making comments about things that you think are important or you have questions or concerns about, I'm listening at this point to hear things that will help me as we start working on the manager's recommended budget. So at this point, the preliminary general fund budget, that's the vast majority of our budget, the requests from all groups total up to a little over $168 million. For county government, the current requests from county departments and other functions that we have is a little over $114 million. You can see how that breaks down. County services, that's county departments primarily. That's a little over $102 million. Mental health is our maintenance of effort funds that we're required by law to spend on mental health services. There's our debt service information, that transfer and other funds. Those are dollars that we'll be sending over into our capital plan. I'm going to spend this evening really talking about
the operating budget for county government. We've talked a lot about the capital plan, the bonds, and our own capital needs. I'm not going to talk about that so much tonight, but if you have questions, we'll certainly answer. The education groups, that's ACC and ABSS, the total request at this point is a little $50.5 million. And we also have 19 outside agencies that have requested a total of a little over $3.4 million. And we will talk about how those break down, how much of that is county money and how much of that is not. So for personnel requests, at this time, we have a total of 22.5 position requests from all across county government. You can see general government is asking for 6 new positions. Public safety is requesting 11. The library is requesting a half a position. And human services is requesting 5 positions for a total of 22.5. We do have some reclass requests from departments. Maintenance and social services are asking to make some changes to some of their positions to upgrade them. And we also have new career ladder requests for 3 departments. We have many departments that have career ladders, not all do. Veteran Services, the Board of Elections, and the County's Maintenance Department are asking to institute career ladders this year. So just a little bit, a quick overview of the new position requests and from the here in the budget information. The County Manager's Department, we are proposing to add an office assistant to our load. This is primarily to help Tori. Tori has about 50 plus boards and committees that she's assigned to take care of. And I will tell you, that is quite a task. This position would help her do that, as well as help her with administrative duties for our department. She spends a great deal of time preparing minutes, preparing for these meetings, so that's something to consider. We also have requests for 2 new positions for the IT department and emergency services tech. This is related to the growth that is occurring in our emergency services, and they depend on technology. We have 1 now. IT believes it would be beneficial to add another one. And also, they're requesting a new network technician. The planning department, they are requesting 2 planning positions. We've all seen over the past 6 to 8 months how much land use discussions we are having. We've talked about if we move into becoming more involved in regulating land use, there would be value in having additional staff in the planning department. This is the request for planning is attempting to address those needs. We also have a request that is at least 2 years in a row, maybe more, from the tax department for a real estate transfer clerk. This is a critical need because it's affecting how quickly properties are being recorded and shown to have been transferred, and this is very important. For public safety, we have requests for new positions. Our Central Communications 911 department is asking for a quality assurance training assistant position. Also asking for a shift supervisor, to put a shift supervisor on the night schedule. This was a recommendation that came out of one of our reviews of some of our operating protocols in CCOM. And they're also asking for 2 new telecommunicator positions. These would not be shift work as we normally do. These would be 2 telecommunicators that would target the peak times for calls, which is 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. We're also seeing requests for personnel from our Emergency Medical Service, EMS. They're asking to basically add a new truck with a 4-person crew that would be for the BLS transport. This is our not emergency, much less critical transport, but the demand for that service is going up. So they're proposing to add a truck, which you'll see in a moment, and 4 new EMT basic positions. They're also requesting a new to add a mechanic. We have 1 mechanic now, and understand from Ray that Ken stays very busy maintaining their fleet. They do most of their work in-house. It's very specialized work, asking for us to consider adding a 2nd mechanic. And also a quality management position that would be responsible working with the medical director to review the care that the paramedics give and look for trends and give feedback. And we also have in the public safety arena, the Sheriff's Department has proposed to add an attorney specifically for the Sheriff's Department, which I think was discussed during the Sheriff's presentation. And we have the library has asked for a part-time circulation assistant. This would be put at the North Park Library. So there's a request to add a part-time circulation assistant out at North Park. And then in Human Services, our Health Department is requesting a total of 3 new positions, a new environmental health specialist, which would help ensure that permit turnaround times stay low. I think that's been something that our developers and our builders are interested is making sure permit turnaround time from environmental health stays low. I will say, it's important to note that this position is being proposed, the cost is proposed to be covered by fees that would be increased to do that. And then, health is also asking to take two positions that are human service planner positions that are, they have been contracted positions, and make them into county employee positions, and they would be covered by state funds. So for health's perspective, these two positions are going to be covered either by an increase in fees or by funds from the state. Stacy, I don't know if you have anything you'd like to add about those positions.
No, you covered them both. There'd be no local tax dollars.
And then from the Department of Social Services, DSS is asking to add two new positions. One is an attorney. They have a tremendous caseload for their current attorney, and I think we all know Jamie Hammett. Jamie Hamlet, she does a fantastic job, but they believe that they're currently contracting for services that help Jamie, and they believe that they could do that much more efficiently by having a second attorney on staff, and they would offset some of those costs by reallocating the contract monies. And then they also are requesting, DSS is also requesting to add this new income maintenance investigator. This is like the fraud investigator. They have one at this time, and she does a fantastic job, finds a tremendous amount of money that people are spending in ways they should not spend. And so DSS is asking to add a second fraud investigator position, and funds from outside county government would play a big role in helping to offset those calls. So I don't know, Adrian or Kelly, would you like to add anything about the DSS request? Okay. And then at the landfill, we have requests for one new position, a heavy equipment mechanic. The landfill currently contracts this work out, and they believe it would be better to have a mechanic on staff, in-house, focusing on their heavy equipment. As you know, they have set up a really robust capital program at the landfill that has helped us get these fantastic compaction rates, right? They stay on top of their equipment. They keep their equipment well maintained. They believe having a mechanic would help them. And they're also asking to request to reclass two positions from landfill attendant to lead, and what that would do. Right now, we don't have a supervisor often on duty at the landfill at the front end. This would create two positions that would be considered supervisors and would be in charge of running the front end, particularly on weekends. So so that's just a very brief overview of the request for new positions, 22.5 total from county government. I want to talk for just a moment about what we're thinking about doing for employee compensation and benefits. Right now, we currently have a 2% merit plan in place. We have run the cost of, and that has been successful. It has led to a complete revamp of how we do employee evals. Every employee gets evaluated now. Everyone has been trained in how to use the performance evaluation documents. HR has done a great job of training people on how to do this. It's been very effective. It's currently 2%. We have talked about the possibility of taking that to a 3% plan, but the cost for the entire merit plan would be a little over $733,000. That includes the 2% that's already in place. We've also priced and looked at a graduated salary adjustment, and this is not a cost of living. This would be raises for employees based on where you fall in your current pay scale. So if you are working for the county and you're in your pay range, we have an entry level, we have a midpoint, we have the high end, right? In this case, with this program that we've priced, $760,000, if you're in the lowest quarter of your pay scale, if you're down in the lowest 25%, you would receive a 2% raise. If you're in the next quarter, going up to the midpoint, still below midpoint, but between the lowest quarter and midpoint, you would receive a 1.5%. If you're midpoint up to the highest next quarter, which would be from like 50 to 75% of the range, you would get 1%. And if you're at the highest part of your pay range, you would only get 0.5%. Again, this is really to try to address our turnover that we're experiencing. You know, this past year, we really focused on the high turnover positions. We did instead of a merit, they got their 2% July 1. The current unemployment market that we're in is making it difficult for us to hold on to particularly good high-qualified employees. We felt like this is a possible way to address high turnover across the board, to be equitable across county government, but
put the focus on where turnover is occurring, which is in primarily in the lower paid, or lower paid jobs, or when people are coming in off the street and making less money. We're looking at a $584,000 increase to the county's health insurance plan. That's an effort to continue to keep us digging out of our $2 million hole. I keep saying this, I'm gonna knock on wood, I'm cautiously optimistic about this fiscal year, but it is going to continue to take more dollars in that plan to pull it out. I would love for us to be in a place where we had $3 to $4 million in savings and we were paying our bills every year. We are not there. This is just another step.
What will be in the positive or so far this year?
I think at this point, can I say that we look like we might be $1 million ahead, or is that
in the quarterly report.
So we're doing well this year. We're gaining on it. That's right. Again, this has been a finding in our audit for the past 2 or 3 years, and we've been told that we will also, as we start moving into these bonds, we're going to have to go down and talk to the LGC about this specific issue to make sure they understand. We recognize it. We know it's an issue. We have a plan. That's right. Now, we're seeing the same thing in dental and in workers' comp. We need to increase our contributions from county government to keep those funds healthy and to stay on top of cost increases in both of those programs. And then the state has changed retirement, and we're going to be required to increase the county's contribution for employee state retirement. You can see that the total we're estimating that to be is a little over $489,000. Law enforcement will receive a 1.2% increase for retirement, and all other employees a 1.26. This is what county government has to pay. So just a little word here about equipment requests from county departments. Emergencies, this is a list of emergency service equipment requests. CECOM has proposed and indicated that, and this has also come from conversations with the fire community, that we need to install a VHF transmit system. We're having issues across Alamance County with pagers, pagers not being able to reach fire departments, not being able to reach inside of our fire departments. A number of years ago, the FCC had we had to turn down the strength of our VHF broadcast. That really means what we need to do is install another tower. So this $800,000 cost is for a new tower. It's also for a replacement backup equipment in the communications center.
Brian, on that, is that something can be added onto an existing tower, or is that?
Yes. It would be equipment that I think we have sited the area that we think is best for this equipment to be in, but we would want to site it on a tower that's already up. So this is strictly, I believe the equipment, the VHF transmit equipment is around $600,000. Backup equipment in the center is around $150,000, I think. And then EMS for the new ambulances are asking for a power load stretcher and a striker load system. These are the stretchers that are motorized and lift the patient, and with the load system is how they can automatically get them into the
back savers.
Yes, back savers, and keeps patients from falling off. I think EMS has indicated to me that that's unfortunately an injury that we have had in the past. Now we've replaced all, I think I'm saying this correctly, I think we have replaced all of our stretchers with this system, and it's better for the patient. It's certainly better for the paramedics too. And then in emergency management, we're looking at getting a new trailer. I believe this is for our drone that we have in EM, and this would be paid for with LEPC funds, $10,000 for a trailer designed to haul the drone. And then for general government, we have several requests, shells for the clerk of court, a new ID badge system for HR, some security for some buildings for maintenance. And Parks has a large request of different pieces of equipment, mowers and chippers and all kinds of different field equipment for the Parks Department. The total Alamance County equipment request, public safety and general government, is a little over $1 million, as you see there on the slide. Vehicle requests, we have received requests from our emergency services departments. EMS, the total request for EMS is $485,000. That's one new ambulance. That is the new ambulance for the new BLS unit, right? So it's the four folks, the four new EMT basics, one new truck, brand new to add to the fleet, and then one replacement ambulance. So one ambulance, old ambulance comes off the line, new ambulance goes on the line, one remount and one replacement medic unit.
fire marshal has requested one replacement truck, just a general truck for their fleet, and then a replacement air truck. The air truck that the fire marshal operates now is in bad shape. It does need to be replaced. That is the lion's share of that $400,000. I think it's about $350,000, $360,000. This is a once in a many year replacement.
So how long does a truck, like, what's the lifespan?
Look around, see if I see any of my fire marshal folks. I think the one that we have, I'd be hesitant to say, if there's a fire marshal in the house next door, maybe they could come over.
Do we have a fire marshal in there?
20 years. It's been around for some time. Jesse, you can speak to what you think the life expectancy would be of a new air truck.
Right now, the truck is going on 15, 16 years on the air truck. We've had numerous issues with it breaking down. We've even contacted the company who built the truck, and they've actually lost all the wiring specs to the truck. So we're actually starting from scratch on getting things fixed with it. We're hoping the truck will last between 15 and 20 years, is what we're based on right now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesse. The detention center has asked for two replacement transport vans. These are not part of ICE or U.S. Marshal. These are for our local inmate transport. So this is strictly Alamance County inmate transports. And the Sheriff's Department is requesting their 12 replacement patrol vehicles, which is what we do every year. I think we've done this for a number of years. And then in the general government side of the house, we're asking for, or inspections has requested a new vehicle. IT and is requesting a new van. Our maintenance department's asking for a replacement flatbed dump truck. The one they have is pretty well worn, but this one we're looking at requesting one with a snow plow that would help with snow removal in our county lots. Parks is asking for a replacement truck and also a couple of replacement vehicles. Social Services is asking for one replacement van and a replacement SUV. All this about replacements basically means these are not new vehicles added to the fleet. They will be rolling off older, worn vehicles. And the tax department is asking for two replacement vehicles. So the total vehicle request for county government at this point is a little over $1.5 million. I will say that we have gone through an exercise to look at the equipment that's been requested, the vehicles that have been requested, what that might look like if we financed some of that. And we're, I'm not prepared to talk about that now. We're going to weigh that option. And if it makes sense and seems like an efficient way to do it, we'll talk about that at manager's recommendation.
Instead of just buying it straight out, yes. Right?
Yes, I will say I have some interest in seeing how we might set up something similar to our capital plan for buildings, where we say we have recurring funds annually for vehicle and equipment replacement that we kind of freeze in place as its own world that it operates in.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So we can find a way to try to manage our vehicle and equipment requests, particularly for emergency services, as they continue to grow and they get all these calls. We need to figure out a better way to manage that, and it may be we can do it through a combination of financing and purchasing. But this just gives you an over
question. If we're doing replacement vehicles and they're replacing them on an annual basis, kind of six of one and half a dozen of the other, isn't it? If you finance it versus just going ahead and paying for it, because it's going to come up again next year.
That's right. I think what we've looked at is some vehicles are purchased. So can you have a vehicle and equipment plan that says we're always going to have an allocation of this much?
Right.
That's going to do our share of vehicles, right? We get those every year. But then air trucks, CECOM, the special right. equipment, we're looking at
$400,000 a lot for one piece of yes. equipment. Or
yeah,
$350,000.
That's right, and it is based on looking at what's something we do every year and what's something that's a special one time event.
Right. Okay.
Can I go back to that slide of the original general fund request?
Yes.
Yeah, there it is. Right.
See, 17-18 we had 147.6, 18-19 had 152.3, and then this one's 168.4.
That's correct.
Okay. Well, granted, 17-18 and 18-19 was after it was pared down some and so forth. you know, the percentages have always been 10, 12% higher than the year before. What do you think this one is here? Figure it out.
So approved general fund budget, I think, was it 152? So we're 152, where the approved general fund budget for 18-19 was 152 million roughly, so that's an additional 16 million. So we're about 10, is that the amount?
10%.
Yeah, maybe 10%. So I think that's run pretty true to what we see at requests. So it's a lot of work to get from request to the balanced budget. A lot of prioritization. Just a few notes about some other, not necessarily equipment, not vehicles. The library materials, we have a request of a little over $250,000 for books and AV materials for the library. And we also have some $647,000 worth of projects that are for IT. Our maintenance department, maintenance has projects that get in the capital plan, but then they also have some smaller scale projects that are under $10,000. Recreation department has a list of projects here that include work at Cedar Rock Park and also some work out at E.M. Holt Athletic Complex. And then the Sheriff's Department is requesting a little over $100,000 for computers and cameras and equipment that they make use of through cars and their buildings. So I want you to take a look at this capital improvement plan. This is the plan for fiscal year 19-20. This plan, this is county government. This is just county government listed in this list. And it is based on the capital plan that we've been working with the school system and the community college on. And, you know, as I've told you many times, what we've done is take our debt step down and freeze it in capital. We froze the school system's debt step down in capital. We froze ACC's and ours. So by leaving debt step down in the county's capital piece of the capital plan, we will have capacity in 19-20 to borrow up to $5 million to do some serious repair work around county government buildings. This is the list, and this happens whether no matter what happens with the capital plan. Right? It's our debt. Our debt's locked into our piece of the plan. This is a list of what we think are priority items that would be done with that $5 million. You can read through them. A lot of it is work to the jail, the courthouses. We do have some work down at the Eli Whitney Gym. That work is to replace a almost failed septic system. So that's a critical piece of work that needs to be done. But we've really tried to focus this $5 million. This would be debt. We would borrow this money. The payments would be made, but it would all be a part of our county capital plan. But as you can see, there's some ADA work that's being done in this that's come from our recent ADA committee. And some work to the Human Service Center. In particular, the largest project on here is the HVAC retrofit over at the Human Service Center. That has been a project that has been needed to have been done for quite some time, as I think Health and DSS will attest. And it's just the scope of it has been so huge. There's just not been a way to figure out how to pay out of operating $1.5 million to get that work done. So what we're gonna do or look at doing next fiscal year is borrowing $5 million, knocking out all these projects at one time, but staying within the parameters of our capital plan. So we also have a landfill. They're not general fund, they're their own enterprise, as we all know. The landfill is proposing to spend $614,000 on some vehicles, some new trucks and a tractor. They're also proposing to build a new convenience center, ticket booth down at the landfill, and to purchase some dumpsters and do some paving projects where some of their paving is worn. We're also going to see in the landfill's budget for next fiscal year in the operating budget, they are increasing funds for planning and engineering. I've asked the landfill to, you know, we were talking about doing a new road entry, a new second scale. I've asked them to hold off on that. We've been working on the closed Swepsonville site. State asked us to do an assessment of that site, and we have done that and provided that information to the state. I think what we're going to be doing is working with the state. You know, the state of North Carolina is now in post-coal ash mode, right? So there's a lot of looks in Raleigh at how do you monitor closed landfills? How do you monitor all these other kind of possible environmental concerns? So I've asked the landfill to hold off on doing any large-scale projects until we work with the state and figure out, you know, the landfill of Swepsonville is closed. We continue to monitor wells. We're going to be working with them to figure out what does monitoring the Swepsonville landfill look like for the next 20 years. So this is just a shot about debt service.
So our debt service, our total outstanding principal for county government has gone down at this point. Our debt payment is lower. Again, all of this is being used in the capital plan, right? So as the school system or the community college's debt steps down, we're not putting that in operating. We are leaving that in the capital plan to help keep that tax impact low for the bond projects. But this gives you an idea of existing debt. Right now, total outstanding principal as of July 1 is a little over $45 million. You can see how it breaks out. We have some county debt, we have ABSS debt, and we have community college debt that's there. Our debt payment for 1920, just for the existing debt, is almost $9 million. And you can see how that payment breaks out. Also, our legal debt margin, we're projecting that to be a little over $1 billion, but the board has set policies in place that limits that. So it's not truly a big
deal. Most counties would kill for that figure.
That's the truth.
It is the absolute truth. It's almost the lowest in the state. Per capita bond indebtedness is we're right there at the bottom.
And I think
that's proud of.
Indeed, and I think that has put us in the position to be able to take on this other debt for the new bonds, if that's what we choose to do. But that kind of forethought has made that possible. So I want to touch on the Alamance Burma school system. So you can see that the school system's request for this fiscal year for their operations was $42.4 million. And in this fiscal year, the school system received a little over $2.6 million in what we're calling capital outlay PAYGO. And you can see where that came from. That's the $1.6 million from lottery and the $1 million that we gave the school system from school sales tax. So for 1920, as we all know, school system is projecting a operations request of the same dollar amount from 1819, $42.4 million. And their total PAYGO capital outlay request is a little over $3.3 million. If you remember, this is what is a part of our capital plan, the big plan that includes bond projects. But this gives you an idea of where the dollars would come from to make that $3.3 million work. A little over $1 million from lottery and almost $2.3 million from dedicated sales tax. So the school system has kept their operations request flat. Community college, you can see in 1819, we had $3.2 million for operations and $440,000 for the county contribution to the community college for their capital. In 1920, the community college has requested $3.4 million, which is about almost $165,000 increase, about 5% increase for their operations. And then in PAYGO, the capital plan right now shows the community college will receive $870,000 next fiscal year. The college has asked for $1.2 million, so they're asking for about $400,000 more than what our capital plan indicates for them. And then outside agencies, so the total amount requested by outside agencies is over $3.4 million. We have 19 outside agencies. So when you look at this, outside agencies are a little bit confusing to follow because it's grant funds, it's state and federal monies, it's county dollars. We tried to put it in a slide that lays it out as clearly as we can. There's 19 total agencies that are asking for that are outside agencies requesting money. The total pass-through funds, which is non-county dollars, that column pass-through funds is $2.3 million. That means of the 3.4, 2.3 is coming from some other source rather than the county, but we facilitate that. We receive those funds and pass them through. And then for county funds, the total request is a little over $1 million. And you can see the category there, other outside agencies. There's 8 of them, and they are all listed there at the bottom. That includes folks from Rescue that are here, as well as Chamber of Commerce, and you can read all of them and the dollar amounts that they are requesting. So a little bit about revenue. Our tax base for next fiscal year, we are estimating the assessed value of the property tax base for Alamance County to be a little over $14.5 billion. That is a growth in the base of over $373 million in value. That is a 2.62% growth in the base, which is good news. That means there will be additional revenue just without having to do anything. That's fantastic news. We have to use our 17-18 collection rate, which was 98.92%. Jeremy, thank you and your folks in tax. That's a very good collection rate and is going up all the time. Motor vehicle collection rate is at 100%.
And for next fiscal year, we are projecting that one penny on the tax rate will equal $1,444,901 in revenue. So a little bit about revenue sources. At this point, we're seeing property taxes. We're estimating the property tax revenue to be a little over $85 million. That is a $3.5 million increase, which is 4.29% over what was budgeted in 18-19. So we're going to see an increase in property tax dollars coming in. We're going to see an increase, we believe, in sales tax dollars that will come in, about $1.7 million increase in sales tax. And fund balance that was appropriated this fiscal year is $6.6 million. That's not a revenue, but it's a resource. That's what I've started calling that money, is a resource. So to give you an idea about fund balance, as the audit pointed out, our unassigned fund balance, that was a fund balance we just talked about that we've made available to the school system and the community college to help get their bond project design and upfront cost started. Unassigned fund balance at $20.8 million. That's a 14% of our expenditures. It is important to remember that $2.9 million for the animal shelter is in that $20 million. So it's really not $20.8 million available to do whatever we want to with it. $2.9 million of that $20 is spoken for. So. Yes. And you can see how we have budgeted fund balance over the past 5 years. I'm glad to say that 18-19 was the first time in a while that we've gone down in the use of fund balance. We're going to try to do that again this year. Budgeting some fund balance has a purpose, absolutely. But we don't want to keep having to do that. It's, you know, if you look, our profit was $708,000 in 17-18. That is really, really close to spending fund balance, right? So I really would like to find a way, and we'll be working on this for the recommended budget, how to back off budgeting fund balance. So this gives you a big picture idea. I think this is my very next to last slide. This is requests versus revenues, and I've added the word resources there too because I like to talk about fund balance. The general fund request, the total general fund request from everybody, county government, ACC, school system, the works, is the $168 million. Our total estimated resources is a little over $160 million. And that word resources, what I'm including in that is revenues. So our total estimated revenues right now are a little over $153 million. That includes, we are looking at a use of unassigned fund balance at 6.6, and we will be probably using some designated fund balance at about $329,000. So what does all this mean? It means the gap between the requests from everybody that's made a request to county government and the revenues that we have, not fund balance revenues, is a little more than $15 million. That's the gap. If we use fund balance the way that we've used fund balance this fiscal year, the gap would be a little over $8 million. So to balance the budget, if we did not use fund balance, if we didn't budget any fund balance, and we went straight with the requests as they have come in, it's a 10.5-cent tax increase. If you used fund balance the way that we have used this fiscal year to balance the budget with the requests that have come in, it's a 5.78-cent tax increase. Just gives you a point of reference to where we are. And at this point, the plan, the next time we'll talk about budget will be May the 6th, 9 a.m. here in this room. I'll present to you the manager's recommended budget for next fiscal year. So if you have any questions about anything you've seen or anything you've read, we've got department heads here. I know that was a quick look. And of course, as you read through this handout, as you read through this information about each departmental budget, if you have questions, do not hesitate to contact me or any department head directly. If you want to talk to a department head, by all means, they are eager to answer questions. So.
Now, the revenues you're showing there, is that estimated, or is that what we had last year, or is that estimated growth, or what?
So let me go back to, I've already passed it, so I'll have to let you know.
It's right here at the end.
There we go. So this is estimates. So we are, based on trend, based on data that we've received from the tax department, we believe the $3.5 million estimate in that's property tax growth. That's more money coming in. But that's with no tax increase. That's just the base has grown.
Over this year we're in now.
That's right. Okay. An additional $3.5 million over the 18-19 budget. And then for sales tax, it's the same thing. We've looked at trend data. We really studied, sales tax is a little harder to pin down, I think. Susan and Andrew, y'all would agree, it's a little more volatile than the property tax. So we'll continue to look at that dollar amount, but right now for tonight,
we're looking at approximately $1.7 million in additional sales tax revenue coming in. But that may change. We'll keep watching that between now and the 6th.
How much additional sales tax?
$1,734,511 is the estimate.
That's the increase.
Yes, that's the increase.
So the difference in the 10.58 cents and the 5.78 cents.
Is using.
Does 10.58 cents include the 7.04 for the bonds?
No. No, this is just for operating type requests.
So if we look at the bonds, then we're looking at like 17 cents.
If you went with the requests, all requests from county government, which we have never really done, usually we pare these down, we work through and say, okay, how do we prioritize? We work with the departments to make those decisions. So this gives you an idea, though. I think this has been a request from the commissioners in the past to say, just as a benchmark, see where we're at.
Yeah.
There's total requests, and we do very little filtering of the requests. You know, mostly what you're seeing here is most of the requests from the department. There's some that that we look at, but basically this is giving you an idea. I think what this communicates is the use of fund balance is important, but it's also a little bit risky, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm going to try to find a way to bring that down, but fund as much as I can of department and our other partner requests too. All right. That's all that I have. If there's no further questions for me or any county staff.
Good overview. Okay. We'll get down to it.
Good
stuff later.
All right. Thank you so much. No vote required on that tonight. Lot to think about. All right. Now we have a presentation from the Alamance County Rescue Department.
Thank you.
Madam Chair and Commissioners, my name is Kyle Bevner. I'm the President of the Board of Directors of Alamance County Rescue Incorporated. Along with me is Benny Brooks. He's our treasurer. And we have several of our members present tonight. I just wanted to talk to the commissioners and to the community and citizens of Alamance County a little bit about who Rescue is, where we came from, what we've been doing, and where we're going. For those of you who don't know, our rescue started out by five ground firemen who saw the need for a special rescue service in Alamance County. They had homemade tools. They started their meetings in McClure Funeral Home, was given a flower van to start their services. And from there, the commissioners of the county came to them and saw a need for an ambulance service. So Rescue started running ambulance calls because the funeral homes couldn't do it anymore. As Rescue continued running ambulance calls, the county commissioners again came to Rescue and said, hey, we just started an emergency medical services. Can you help us? And they did. The first Alamance County EMS, I think, was in around 1973. And it was composed of all Rescue members. The first EMS director was a Rescue member, and they ran calls on paid Monday through Friday, and then the volunteers of the Rescue Squad ran the calls on the weekends without compensation. EMS continued forward and utilized the building the Rescue owns on the corner of Maple and McAden for 30 plus years, rent free, and very, very minimal maintenance to that building. EMS then built a new building, gave us our building back, and the mechanic from EMS continues to utilize the portion of the building that the county built for that purpose, which is owned by the county. After EMS got started, Rescue then turned around and visualized and focused strictly on specialty resources, specialty services, heavy machinery and vehicle extrication. Water rescue, which consists of swift water, steel water, and dive rescue. We also have a canine rescue team. We also do high angle and low angle rescue and some confined space. In the packet that we have given you, explains a lot of this. But one of the main reasons we're here this evening is that we have a lot of aging equipment, and we do fundraisers. Well, let me back up. Brian presented to your budget that we do receive $100,000 of funding from the county, which provides some operational along with paid staff during the day. And the reason that we have done the paid staff during the day is because 30 years ago, when 50 plus years ago, when Benny first started, they could leave their jobs and run the calls whenever a call came out. This day and time, they cannot leave their jobs. And it's our mission to the citizens of the county and to use the commissioners to provide a service that we've contracted with you to provide. So we take some of those funds and our volunteers. We don't have anybody outside of our organization that works during the week. You know, someone's there primarily 7 days a week. There are days here and there that people are at their full-time jobs and can't do it, but other than that, it's covered 7 days a week for 8 hours a day. In that $100,000, we pay that hourly rate that they're there. We also allocate $25,000 into a capital reserve, which ultimately leaves us with about $16,600-some-odd in operating money. We supplement that money that we get from the county with fund drives. Many of you may have gotten in the mail in the past a letter that is composed by our members, and we contract a company that mails those letters out, and then you can choose to receive a picture with your family or not. And we get a lot of support from the citizens of the county through that. However, as days have gone on, people just don't donate like they used to. And that fund drive is up and down. We may sit, at one point in time when they first started, they were raising about $60,000 better a year. We might see $32,000, $36,000 now, maybe, and that's a big maybe. We supplement that also with gun raffles, golf tournaments. We're getting ready to do a disc golf tournament. We do a lot of stuff. We try not to go out and stand in front of Walmart and other places and ask for money and seem like we're begging, because we're definitely not going to beg anybody for anything. So our main line, and it's a picture here in the book, our main line rescue truck is a 1996 Freightliner FL70. If you look at the picture there, and if you will walk down there and look at the building, you'll say, man, that's a nice truck, because we take pride in our equipment and we try to keep it up. However, that truck is over 20 years old. We have a 1991 model ambulance that the county gave us way before I got into rescue that we still own and operate. And there's a picture of a 1985 model rescue truck there that is still a second line unit that we still own and operate. And then there's a picture of a Suburban towing our boats that's in there as well that we still utilize. We utilize that vehicle both for towing our boats, and we provide a rehab service to the county fire departments, which consists of us responding on a working structure fire, working field fire if it's in the hot summer months, or any variation of it. And we do go some in the winter, but not quite as much. And with that, we bring them water, and we have a cooling system that many of you may have never seen. It's a six-man cool vest system that circulates cold water that through funding of the Alamance County Emergency Service Association and through every single fire department in the county helped us to purchase. And when we're called, we respond to the fire. We set up tents, we set up chairs to rehab those, so these firemen, if they are exerting their energy and their force, that hopefully we can prevent them from going home and have some kind of fatal medical issue, which is, these are proven facts. It's just not something we pull out of the air. There's also a lot of safety of our members that is very, very important to us and should be very important to you. The safety of our members is our utmost concern and priority. We have to provide them with the proper equipment, so when we do have a water rescue, they have the proper water flotation devices, the correct dry suits, the correct wet suits. They have to be maintained. They do have failures. They do get ripped. We just had a car run off into that water retention pond there by True Line a few weeks ago. A couple of the people that are in this room today responded to that call. That water is extremely, extremely nasty. If they have a rip in that suit that you can't see with your eyes and they get contaminated because one of the law enforcement officers had a reaction to something in that water because they didn't have the proper gear, but they were trying to help someone, and my members go into the water to try to get someone and have a reaction that could be fatal to that person. So we have to maintain this equipment, and it's getting to be very, very expensive, and some of the pictures in there. One of the first pictures is our personal protective turnout gear that we wear on any vehicle extrication, any road accident that we respond as a rescue unit, which consists of a two-piece suit, jacket, pants, also consists of boots, helmets, and gloves, which is all that stuff. The suit is together, but then your hat, your helmet, your gloves, and your boots are all separate. And you can see it costs us about $3,900 for one set, and this isn't all of our members that we have to purchase one for every year. Our SCBAs, our breathing apparatus, they need to be replaced. Matter of fact, the SCBAs that we currently have were donated to us by Hall River Fire Department, because they have got funding to get new. And we took their old, and the ones we got rid of were some that donated by E.M. Holt Fire Department. And they're $6,200 a piece, and we have 12 of those to replace. Now, we are not firefighters. We never claim to be, but there are times where you have a situation to where a car is on fire, and after the fire has been extinguished, you still have toxic smoke, fumes, and gases coming from that vehicle, or even into a building where the environment is hazardous, and without the proper breathing devices, it'd be very, very easy for our folks to have some type of reaction or to even have a lung issue down the road, just like the fire department would have if they were to go into a working structure fire. On the next page, you'll see automated external defibrillators. We are required by the state to have just two of those on our ambulances, which we do. We have those on our ambulance, but we also are looking to have those on each of one of our vehicles for the simple fact there may not always be an ambulance there whenever someone has a fatal heart attack of that nature. And it's just very in the line of everybody being an EMT on rescue. If you don't have the proper equipment to do what you do, then people are going to say, why didn't you have it? Where is it at? So something I did fail to mention in the money through the county is there is about $24,000 to $26,000 that comes out of the EMS's budget that helps us, which pays for our fuel, the upkeep to our two ambulances that we have, all of our medical supplies, not the AEDs and that type of capital expenditure, but our general medical supplies, and then the county and the general fund pays for our workers' comp. I don't think it comes directly out of EMS's budget, but I think it's a different fund. Benny, would you like to add anything while I'm talking?
Keep moving, brother.
All right. So, I know. I'm trying to make it fast. If you pass over the page, it's got this page that has the brochure. It has a list of all of our vehicles that we currently own and the year and the model of that truck. Also, it has a little bit of information about our call volume, but I'll continue past that because some more equipment we have. We want everybody here is the jaws of life. We have several sets of those. We've applied for multiple grants for just about every piece of equipment that I've mentioned. We've applied for multiple grants, and there's not many grants for rescue squads out there at all. There is a FEMA grant, and it's a very big grant, and we have applied for that twice. One time we made it to the second cut, then we was cut. But the gentleman that helped us, bless his soul, he's no longer here. He passed away and unable to help us anymore. But he got us to that second phase. That's about as close as we ever got. We just did get a matching grant from the state fire marshal's office where we put up $25,000 and they gave us $25,000 to buy $50,000 worth of equipment. Sound like a lot of money, doesn't go far. When you talk fire, rescue, EMS, the price jumps way high, just even on a chainsaw. But a set of these tools you see in the picture here were hydraulic tools, which is the most state-of-the-art tools that are on the market. You're looking at $25,000 for just two pieces of equipment. And the way vehicles are built this day and time, some of the old equipment we have will not cut it. The type of metal that is used, it just won't cut it. We can pry on it and tear it up all you want all day long, but if it has to be cut, the pressurizing that equipment and the way it's designed will not cut it. Not sitting here telling you we don't have anything that will cut it. We're just telling you that to replace some of our outdated equipment, that's what kind of money we're looking at. And then I'm sure y'all heard over and over again about the radios. So radios are, the Motorola radios are, you know, $5,000, $5,200 a piece. So at the conclusion of what I have to say is I just want to ask what you, the commissioners, can help us do to move forward to find funding to modernize our equipment, to provide safe working environments for our members, to be able to respond to the needs of the citizens of the county, those passing through on this interstate, and sometimes we do respond outside of Alamance County, such as searches and water-related instances.
You hit on interstate. I was going to ask you, how does that add to your number of calls, or what dictates whether you go out or not, even locally versus the interstate? Can you tell us a bit about that?
Our interstate is a very, very major thoroughfare of the county, as everyone knows. We do respond a lot to the interstate. Not every time do we go to the interstate, it's a pin in or a major wreck, but we still respond. You know, we had that major incident in, was it February? I can't remember what year it was now.
A year or two ago.
Yeah, well, we had a 120-some car pileup stretched from the Highway 54 on-ramp into Mebane, eastbound and back westbound. You know, that taxed your EMS service, that taxed fire departments in three districts, that taxed rescue. Not only was our ambulance out there responding with EMS, we had rescue trucks out there, we had members in their private vehicles up and down the interstate triaging patients. So it was a multi agency incident. It was very, very nerve-wracking. I think we've done a lot of work with the county emergency management to maybe make it better next time. It's never going to be perfect. Nothing's ever going to be perfect because the communication world is not perfect, and we're never going to make it perfect. I tell you that I won't sit here and say that the interstate makes us busier, because most of our worst wrecks are right in the city of Burlington and in the outside areas of the county. We do have some major wrecks on interstate, and most of the time they involve 18-wheelers and multiple vehicles. But I will not sit here and tell you that is our main area that we go, because it is not.
Appreciate your honesty on that. Sure you missed Jim Covey here.
Yes.
Just don't know.
Yes. Yes, sir, we do.
Well, two primary vehicles you're looking at replacing, how much would those cost?
The ambulance, if we replace one ambulance, you look at, and I say a minimum, because until you spec a vehicle, you really don't know, of $175,000 to $185,000, and that's just a vehicle without a stretcher. And you know, EMS is going to the Striker power load system, which is a back and lifesaver, let me tell you. We don't have those on our ambulance. We still use manual load stretchers. So you're looking $175,000, $185,000 just for an ambulance. That doesn't count any equipment on it. The large rescue truck we have, and many people may question why a big truck. Well, when that one truck rolls, we can do almost anything to get started, from vehicle extrication to that vehicle being in the water, and they need PFDs to be down in the water, ropes, Stokes basket, you name it, it's on that truck, and we don't have to worry about having three or four trucks rolled just to make sure we have what we need to get started. So that 1996 Freightliner that we have, if we were to replace that truck today, a minimum of $750,000, and as much as $1 million truck and equipment, I will say. So it's, you know, it's just wondering what we can do to get some to look about additional funding. Also, in your packet, in the very back of your packet, there are letters that are signed. We went to every single county fire chief, we went to every single police chief, including the city of Burlington, including the city of Graham, and the mayor of Graham, making sure they support what we do. And they were very supportive of what we do. They said they've always been a support of what we do. There's a letter in here that states that had rescue not arrived on the scene, the call of Burlington here recently, that the outcome for that patient could have been much worse than what had originally been.
Well, I just want to say thank you so much to you and your crew, all you people who work so hard and do so much for the community, and the community just has no idea and doesn't even know how much you give of yourselves, your families give them, you know, your time. I'm sure that you have a lot of little out-of-pocket expenses, things that you do that nobody knows about, and we just really appreciate that.
We
so
sure
much.
Do. We do appreciate it.
And we, you know, I told you, you know, before that, I encourage you, you know, if you, so many of the recs that you respond to are in the city of Burlington, and I believe that you do a good bit for the industry in the city of Burlington and Mebane, that, you know, maybe the city of Burlington and Mebane could find some space in their budgets to help you as well, in addition to what Alamance County is doing for you.
I think the county needs to do more of what we're doing.
I would like to see that as well.
Yeah, I think we all do.
I think we all value very much what you do and, you know, want to find a way that's sustainable long term to help you
that,
continue
that,
to
that
do
is,
work.
You know, Ms. Gailey, that is the, it's very hard for me to call you Ms. Gailey, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
Well, Ms. Gailey, that is, you know, the reason we're here, we want everybody to understand what we do and that the stuff that we face when we're trying to do fundraisers, and we all know that fundraisers work to an extent where it's getting to a point that our sustainability on fundraisers just isn't getting, and we were just hoping that we can find a way that some additional funding somewhere could be found to help us have some sustainability, that way that, you know, not only to citizens but the resources we bring to the fire service are going to remain, not only remain the same, but be able to get better and provide additional resources. Because there's some of the stuff that if rescue weren't here, that you'd have to depend on your USAR team to come from Greensboro or Chapel area with a minimum of an hour time frame for them to come. So we were really, in our training, you know, have some training documentation in there as well. The training these members do and our training officers do are unbelievable. You're looking at 4,000 plus hours a year and man hours of these people training to make sure that if a call comes in and anyone needs us, we're there and we know what to do. We're not just flying by the seat of our britches. But I thank you for your time, and if you have any questions for me, I'll be happy to answer them.
Can I get you to do something here? I want to hear from one of these two young men what made them get the rescue squad. Can you do that? You do what you want.
I'm Brent Allard. I live in Mebane. I'm 20 years old. I'm new to it. I joined the rescue at the beginning of this year. I've been a volunteer in Mebane for a little over a year now, and I'm a full-time firefighter at Whitsitt. I just switched over from Orange County. I didn't necessarily know what I wanted to do when I got out of high school. I joined Mebane as a volunteer. I went through all my certifications, trying to get everything I needed for firefighter 1 and 2 to become full-paid. William Mooney taught most of my classes for my rescue part. And just being with them showed the love that all of us have and the passion we have for being on rescue. Love doing what we love to do, and I wanted to be a part of what they did, so that's why I joined.
We appreciate what you do, too.
Yes, sir. Hi, I'm Landon Flood. I live out in Gibsonville. So how I got started into this was my uncle was actually in the squad, and we were supposed to go we're supposed to go hunting the next morning, and it was Christmas night, I believe, back in 2014, and a call came out, and it was a wreck. And I've ever since I was little, always liked flashing lights and stuff like that, all sorts of emergency vehicle stuff. And so he asked if I wanted to go. I was like, well, heck yeah, I want to go. I mean, it's a chance for me to live a dream. So we go down there. I don't remember exactly where it was, but it was a mother and her two children. And sadly, the mother was drinking and driving, and she went off the road, and she hit a tree, and the car split, and it killed one of her children on impact.
Oh, no,
and so I didn't go outside, or I just stayed inside of the car, but you know, I could hear the mother scream and stuff like that, and just some right there told me that this is what I want to get into. You know, I enjoy helping people and stuff like that. So I joined the rescue squad eventually, and I've been there ever since I was 14 years old, and now I'm almost 18 years old come June, and I'll be a full member, and I won't be a junior anymore.
But take that junior off your name tag.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
But I've witnessed a lot in just a couple years I've been here. The classes and stuff like that that's offered. There's a lot of training. Recently I got certified in like search and rescue and stuff like that, and a couple of others. And it's pretty cool because I'm just 17 years old, but when we had like a search and rescue down here in Graham for a kid, I was in charge of firefighters that were in their 30s and 40s, and I'm just some 17-year-old kid. But I really enjoy what I do here. It's like a second family for me. My mom hears that a lot, and she knows I spend a lot of time down there. But other than that, I mean, that's one thing to look forward to in my life. So,
thank you so much for sharing that with us. That's a very powerful story. You should write that down. Keep a journal of your stuff. You can look back on it.
That's a great idea.
Go wow.
Yeah, journals go a long ways.
Yeah. Well, thank you, gentlemen, very much. We really appreciate you being here. Okay, animal shelter agreements.
Thank you, Commissioners. At this time, you have in your packet a proposed agreement between the City of Burlington and Alamance County for the details, the proposed call share operations of the Animal Services Center. It's operated by the City of Burlington. The costs are now distributed at this time among the participating cities as well as Alamance County. We've been working with the City of Burlington as well as our other municipal partners to come up with a new agreement, a new formula to figure out how the cost of the Animal Services Center should be distributed. And we've come up with, working with the City of Burlington, a formula based on local sales tax distribution. Basically, you take the way the sales tax is distributed to our cities based on a per capita method and use it to figure out how to pay for the operational costs of the Animal Services Center so everybody pays their fair share. If we adopt this agreement, the City of Burlington will use the sales tax data from the North Carolina Office of Management and Budget every year to figure what the county share would be. This is a step up in our financial responsibilities for paying for those operating costs of the shelter. We go from paying 44% now to 62% of the shelter costs, but we do that over a four-year period, which I think is helpful to us. It's something that we gradually phase into. The agreement itself that you have before you is for 5 years. It expires June 30th, 2025. I think that's a good idea. That means we get back together with the cities and renegotiate and relook at the terms of the proposed agreement. And there's also a clause in the agreement that says if the Animal Service Center budget were to increase by 10% or more in one year, all the managers would get back together. That is not an automatic. That would not be just a given that we would pay for. We would get the opportunity to sit back down with the city and say, hey, what's going on? Which I think that'd be very helpful so we're all on the same page. One thing that I am supportive of with this is that it will give us a new means to also figure out how we bill for our 911 services. We have multiple cities that pay us currently for our 911 services. That agreement is, I think, from 1996, and we need to modernize that agreement. I think using this same formula would be fair. All the city partners are agreeing to this model for animal services. We would, I would propose that we use the same model for CECOM billing, and I've let the cities know that that would be our interest. The county attorney's office is working on a draft of a new agreement that would do that for central communications. And then, so on the animal services side, using this new formula, we go from 44% to 62% of the cost becoming the county's responsibility. If we implement the same formula for CCOM, we currently pay 85% of the CCOM operations, we go to 77%. So using this formula for both CCOM and the Animal Services Center balances us out. It's more cost to the county over the 4 years, but it's balanced by making it uniform. Plus, it gives us a uniform way to figure how to cost share CCOM and the Animal Services Center. We would put the same terms in the CCOM agreement. It would be a five-year agreement. If there was a 10% increase in the CCOM budget, we would get back with the city. So it would be very similar. This agreement, though, you know, we don't have our agreement drafted yet. Clyde's office is working on that now. The agreement from the City of Burlington has an early termination clause that we would give notice to the City of Burlington by December 31st if we want out. The only way I would suggest to the board that we would do that if you approve this agreement tonight is if for some reason the cities don't want to use the same formula. I've had a little bit of question back and forth with the cities that participate with us for the 911 services. I think they all feel like this would be fair. If you do it for one service, you do it for the other. But in the event that doesn't work out, we would have the ability to get out of this this agreement and start renegotiating. My hope would be the board will pass this agreement. The board will, yes, and we'll do both. Yes. We do have Rachel Kelly here this evening. I believe she may be over in the overflow room. Rachel Kelly from the City of Burlington, as well as Jess, I think we all know from the Animal Service Center. So if I'm sure they'll be heading over here in the event you have any questions. It is an increase for county government to make these payments. I would suggest to the board that we do this with the understanding that we will use the same formula for a CCOM agreement with the cities too for the same five-year period.
Do you think that's a fair deal for us?
It does increase our costs, but as I think Mr. Kimmery was here earlier, the concerns have been from some of these small cities like Green Level, I think Village of Alamance, I can't remember. So there are several smaller cities that feel like they are paying an unfair share right now, and the county has a better capacity to be able to do that. I would agree with that, and I think limiting it to 5 years, so it's revisited in 5 years, is a good idea. And I think, again, if we apply this same formula and same model to CCOM, I think it's the fair thing to do. So,
do we have any insight into what Mr. Kimmery was talking about when he said their share had gone up 148%?
I couldn't speak to that. I know the budgets for animal services are like CCOM. They will continue to go up because if you have people get pay raises or if you've added some kind of new piece of equipment, they're always going to, for the most part, advance. I think as long as you're using a percentage, a formula, you're all advancing together relative to how your ability to pay, I guess you would say. But I can't speak to why the city's seen that.
So this is based on the sales tax rate?
As opposed to per capita.
And dividing it by the number of citizens in each of your entities, is that correct?
Yes. I don't know if y'all want to, is there any other clarification for it? I think that's...
All right. Well, if anybody wants to make a motion to
approve... I'll make a motion. We approve that.
I'll second it.
All right. We have a motion and a second to approve this agreement. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. All right, we have a budget amendment from the sheriff. Is someone here to present that?
I was going to present that. I think the sheriff and the chief deputy are at a conference. So what we have, commissioners, for your consideration is the budgeting of federal forfeiture funds received during this fiscal year, 2018-19. The total dollar amount of federal funds that have come in this fiscal year is $158,274.74. So we do not project these funds. We're under instructions from the Department of Justice that we can't supplant the sheriff's budget with these dollars, so we don't project them for the year, but they come in. So what we're suggesting that the board do is budget the dollars that are available, that have come in this year, add them to his banked amount that he has in the bank right now. So
I'll make a motion that we approve that.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any more discussion?
Yeah, before we vote, I was hoping that we could ask questions, but I'm not going to belabor that point. But I think that it's important that we look at this guide that was supplied to us. I asked for it, we got it, and it shows what all we can use the money for, other than what we were using it for.
Yes.
And how much is available? Do you know?
Susan, do you know the Sheriff's Department's current available balance of federal funds?
Currently, this fiscal year, we have received $158,274.74, which is the budget amendment before you now. In the past few years, if you'll give me just a second to pull that up.
Do you know what he has banked right now?
That's what I'm looking up now. Each year, because those are federal dollars, we are not able to just add those into the general fund. They are set aside for his purposes as the equitable sharing account guidelines give us. Hang on just a minute. Let me get to that file real quick. I can tell you what we have as his banked amount. Bear with me just a second.
If I knew an interesting story, I would tell it. I can think of one right now. So.
You got numbers.
That's right.
Here we go, here we go, here we go, here we go. We're almost there.
Right at this time of night, there are no interesting stories.
It is.
Once there was a meeting,
that's right.
Everybody went home.
Yeah, we can discuss the Game of Thrones.
That's right.
Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones.
It was just the new
season's really good. Really good.
What did you think about
headbutts? Here we go. We have set aside four federal forfeiture funds that we have received in past years of $299,747.33.
How much again? I'm sorry.
$299,747.33.
That covers what period?
That is funds that we have received prior to July 1 of 2018. So that was the balance. We had a balance of $374,035.85 July 1 of 2018 that we had set aside, and we have brought four budget amendments to the board this year where we have allocated $136,885 of those funds.
So how much does he have available now then?
So in the set aside funds we have $299,000, and then for the current year receipts $154,000, so we put those two together, slightly under $400,000.
Right.
And what is he asking for? What's the total? $166,000.
No, it was okay. Almost $300,000, I think, that he's interested in spending.
Well, what I'm saying, it would behoove all of us to know what we can do with Kate. Now, you take for instance, and I'm not suggesting that we do it. I mean, you know. Sometimes you say something, you inquire, or somebody can hold and says that you're negative about the department. Well, that's hardly the case. But, you know, unless I misread this, you can pay overtime out of this money. And that would be overtime we wouldn't have to pay. So there is a possibility of some savings there. As far as, I know he can't shift it over to the general fund, but if he paid it, we wouldn't have to pay anything.
Right.
So I think it behooves all to know what we can do and can't do. And until I saw this, I didn't know what the limits were.
Certainly.
But there's definitely some limits, and it's more open than you think.
Well, if I remember right, we had a motion and a second, didn't we? Is there more discussion on that?
Yeah, I'm okay with this.
All right. All in favor then, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Maternal and child health budget amendment.
Yes, I apologize. That should just say health. They should both just say health and dental health. So your first budget amendment from health is an additional appropriation from the Division of Public Health through the Department of Health and Human Services in the amount of $9,776. And this budget amendment is a revision to our existing agreement addenda 101 for maternal child health. And so you've probably heard me say a couple of times now that back in 2007, the General Assembly appropriated about $2 million from the Maternal Child Health Block Grant to a special project. And now those funds are being reappropriated back to the local health departments, and so that's what this revision is. These funds will be used for educational videos around labor and delivery and breastfeeding, baby supplies, home visiting supplies like scales and stethoscopes, and maternal risk factors training for our staff. It's all state funds.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
All right, and so our second budget amendment is for the dental clinic, which you'll remember is 100% self-sustaining, no local tax dollars there. And they've been awarded $5,000 from Delso Dental Foundation in the form of a foundation grant to be used to purchase digital x-ray equipment. I believe this is the third year we've received the Delta Dental grant, so we're very fortunate, and no local tax dollar match.
So moved. Or second.
We have a motion and a second to approve this budget amendment. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
and we had no public speakers to sign up on other matters. So we have a county manager report.
Yes, indeed. I wanted to just go over some, just very quickly, some dates and what we're seeing as it pertains to the heavy industrial development ordinance that's in the works right now, as well as our budget. And we've talked with the legal department about how this calendar might look. I know we put out a budget calendar, but I want to put this date range and these actions in front of the board and see if there's a consensus about how we're going to proceed. So in order for us to accommodate the heavy industrial development ordinance process, we would be looking at May the 6th, a presentation to the commissioners that would give a draft of the heavy industrial development ordinance to the board for your review. And then we would look at setting a public hearing that night, that morning on the 6th, for May the 20th. So the public hearing to, if the ordinance is reasonable and acceptable, we would set a public hearing for the heavy industrial development ordinance for May the 20th.
Hey,
also,
I'm sorry,
go ahead.
Very good. Yeah. Maybe we should update the board about the progress that the planning board has made and the issue that we have with the, I'll just do that since I started talking.
Yeah, just bring it on.
So if the presentation of this draft is done on May 6th, it will not have been approved by the planning board. The planning board was scheduled to meet its monthly meeting last Thursday, but that did not happen because they did not have a quorum. So the chairman of the planning board, Rodney Cheek, recessed the meeting in hopes of rescheduling for the following Thursday, which will be Thursday this week, in the anticipation of having a quorum for that. And then by recessing and going about it that way, then you don't have the public notice requirements attached. Well, Tanya Cattle called around to the planning board members today and found out that they're not going to be a quorum for this coming Thursday either. So the next regularly scheduled planning board meeting will be after May the 6th. I don't have that date at the top of my head. But we do not have an opportunity for the planning board to meet in a regularly scheduled meeting. They could try to have a called meeting, but then we have the issue with next week being spring break for ABSS and all of that. So we're looking at kind of sort of two options. One, having the presentation of a draft that's been professionally prepared, as Commissioner Sutton was saying, by Tanya Cattle and working with Ben from the legal department. They would work on taking the work of the subcommittee of the planning board that has been working on this for several months, pulling that together into a draft to present to the Board of Commissioners on May the 6th and setting a public hearing. Or if we really wanted the planning board to vote on this as a body before bringing it up here, then we could attempt to extend the moratorium but past June the 3rd. But that is an entirely separate process. So that plus May 6th would be the presentation of a draft heavy industrial development ordinance that had been finalized by Tanya Cattle and Ben Pierce. And then also we would have the manager recommended budget on May 6th. So back to you.
Now we vote on the ordinance.
Well, we have to have a public hearing
first
before we can vote on it.
Okay. See, I've got a class that morning.
I'm not going to be here. I'm going to floodplain certification for the county, the 6th through the 8th.
I would think that we just push it out and do the extension on the moratorium and make it work in our schedule possible.
That sounds like a good idea.
Well, there's requirements to extending the moratorium. Mr. Albright, can you tell us about that? What's involved in extending the moratorium?
Well, the board has to consider the factors as to why the amendments haven't been made. And you just mentioned one. Not being able to get a quorum for the meeting. I don't know how close they are to getting some type of plan approved. They could possibly have a meeting on May 2nd. Maybe.
I haven't talked to the chair yet about that move of the date, what that date might look like, so we haven't really polled the board members for a different day.
But to extend the moratorium, to get back to your question, you have to show these factors that have prevented you from making the amendments. And I think you're pretty close to getting all your amendments made from what I've talked
maybe
to.
Maybe there's a lot of discussion at the planning board.
Right. I would think there's probably going to be a little bit more discussion before you finalize that. Just haven't been there a little bit.
So do you think we can meet the requirements of the statute? Do you think that not being able to get a quorum?
If they're not able to get a quorum and they can't call a special meeting and the director has just indicated she's not going to be available.
Well, that's two factors in itself.
All of those are factors into extending it.
Okay, so what do we have to do to extend the moratorium then?
Well, we have to have another public hearing to extend the moratorium sometime between now and June 3rd.
We have to have another public hearing to extend
the moratorium. And we discussed the factors we've just discussed.
And we could do that on our May 6th calendar.
You can.
If we decide to do
it. Shouldn't take long.
We can, so we scheduled a moratorium to be extended on May 6th and set the public hearing for May 20th.
Mm-hmm. And then you'll be within your June 3rd moratorium deadline.
Now, we voted on anything May the 6th. I don't mind missing that meeting. We're not voting.
No, we won't.
Okay. No, we'll miss the recommended budget.
That's my last day of class. And I have to give
and we'll seven. Set to do I a public hearing on the 20th.
Okay.
And so then, when will we be? So then, when is the next planning board meeting?
May 9th is the next scheduled meeting.
Okay.
Don't do that,
Tim.
And how long would, if we do, was it 59 days would be the extension?
Yes.
Well, how was 59 days from June 3rd?
Could happen. I don't know.
Ish.
Probably August
1st.
August 1st, August 2nd.
Yeah. 59 days from June 30th?
Mm-hmm. No.
June 30th.
Okay.
August 2nd.
So then we would have the May 20th, we would have the public hearing on extending the moratorium. And then June 3rd, we're not going to vote on the ordinance because we're extending it. When we discussed it earlier today, we were talking about having the budget public hearing on June 3rd. Do y'all want to try to do the public hearing on the moratorium and the public hearing on the budget on the same night or the same day?
I would think it would be fine.
I don't think
you're going to get a big issue about extending.
So have the budget public hearing on May 20th. And that's a night meeting, because if it was June 3rd, then we'd have to make that a night meeting to accommodate people. Okay. Okay. And then, all right.
So we said May 6th, manager recommended budget. May 20th is the... Is that the budget public hearing?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, got it.
And the moratorium public hearing. And do y'all have any thoughts about where you want to have the budget public hearing since we're talking about it? Do y'all want to go to Cummings? We can do that. Last time we went to Southern, the year before we were at Williams. Do you want to go to Cummings? You don't care?
Yeah, that's fine.
All right.
So is that, we're going to go to Cummings?
That's okay with
me. Yeah, it's okay with me. Yeah.
All right. Well, sounds good. Then, has anybody got any commissioners' comments?
Nope. I'll save them.
Okay. Then we'll be...
I do want to make one comment. I still don't feel like we've done a good job for our citizens in Snow Camp. And that's bothering me a lot. Glad to say we can't put a time frame on a business, but
if they get excessive noise, well, that still could be a problem, right?
That's best addressed in your heavy industry order.
Okay.
Instead of a noise order.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, that's not going to help the people in Snow Camp because that thing's already been permitted. And really go to Steve's point that we doesn't feel like we've done much to help them because.
Glad, do you have any ideas about that?
Well,
what's legally can we do?
We haven't heard from the Mining Commission. We don't know what they're going to say. We don't know what requirements they're going to put on them. And you still have that third step. Remember, I told you about the operational permit portion of it. And, well, your planning director jumped ship. I was going to ask her about it, but that's a portion where you can add some rules to the operational permit.
Do we have input to that as commissioners,
yes,
or is that good?
Yes. That's a function of the ordinance.
Okay.
Because that comes back to the planning.
There you go.
You don't leave long.
I was talking about the operational side of the Snow Camp mining permit. Once they get the state permission to proceed, if they do, then it comes back to us for the operational.
Right, community. They actually get everything, their buildings and kind of everything established. We go out, do a site visit to say, yes, what you've done looks like what we approved. Then they get that operational permit.
Right, but they have to maintain their distance, they have to have their buffer, they have to have their berms.
How about do they have to have any what you call them, berms?
They have to have setbacks and buffers, they do.
Okay.
They have an approved site plan, we're looking for them to draw and do exactly what they've already drawn and do it in the field, and if we find something that isn't in compliance, we don't give a permit.
Okay,
can we put time restrictions on them in that permit? Operating times?
I don't know that we can do that.
I don't think so. Our ordinance doesn't allow for that.
Because it's unfortunately it's special.
All right, anybody has any more comments? If not, we're adjourned.
Mr. Sutton.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.